Shalom, brothers and sisters, all praise to the Most High God. This is the Feast of Pentecost. Brothers, how are you doing?
All praise.
Sisters, how are you doing? All praise to the Most High. All praises. Sisters, looking glorious as ever. All praise to the Lord this day. Brothers, Avengers. All praises to the Most High God this day. All praises. So, we're going to get right into it, okay? Apologies that we are late. I'm going to throw Soldier Jonah under the bus, okay? All praise to the Most High. So, today's topic, the Feast of Pentecost, okay? The Feast of Pentecost, all praise to the Most High. Take your notes out, all right? This is the classroom, take your notes. Okay, your Bibles and all that. All right. We're going to open up with the book of 1 Kings, chapter 8, verse 46. 1 Kings 8:46. All right. 1 Kings 8:46. Let's start there. So as you all know, the Feast of Pentecost, we are in the land of our captivities. To observe the Feast of Pentecost, to raise up our sons and our daughters, to rehearse the righteous act of the Most High God. All right. So it's a glorious thing to see this day. 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 46. Come on.
First book of Kings, chapter 8, verse 46.
Come on.
If they sin against thee.
If they sin against thee. That's talking about us, the 12 tribes of Israel. Who's speaking here? King Solomon. King Solomon is praying to the Heavenly Father about the 12 tribes of Israel in the land of our captivity about the last days. Read that part again.
1 Kings chapter 8, verse 46.
Read.
If they sin against thee,
uh-huh.
For there is no man that sinneth not,
come on,
and thou be angry with them.
Because the Lord was angry with us. That's why we went into slavery. Read.
And deliver them to the enemy.
The Most High God delivered us, the 12 tribes of Israel, to our enemies. Read.
So that they carried them away captives.
We was carried away captives into the lands of our enemies. The four corners of the earth, we was carried away captives. We was carried away captives. Come on.
Carry them away captives.
Read.
Unto the land of the enemy.
Uh-huh.
Far or near.
We were carried away captives unto the land of our enemies. Far from our homeland and near to our homeland. Read.
Yet, if they shall bethink themselves.
He says, yet, in the land of our captivity, if we shall bethink ourselves, we shall remember who we are. Read.
In the land whither they were carried captives.
In the lands where we were carried captives, come on.
And repent.
And do what?
And repent.
And repent. So in the lands of our captivity, the Most High God, King Solomon put the spirit, the Most High God put the spirit on King Solomon to do what? To pray to the Lord about the 12 tribes of Israel in the lands of our captivity. That is what King Solomon is prophesying about here, about the last days. He's talking about the last days. He's not talking about during the time of King Solomon. No, he's talking about during the time in the last days. Okay, read that part again. Verse 47 again.
First Kings chapter 8, verse 47.
Read.
Yet if they shall bethink themselves.
Yet if they shall bethink themselves, we shall remember who we are. Read.
In the land whither they were carried captives.
In the land where we were carried captives, come on.
And repent.
And do what?
And repent.
And repent. That's the key right there. The key to our salvation in the land of our captivity is that we must remember who we are and repent in the land of our slavery. Read.
And make supplication unto thee.
Come on.
In the land of them that carried them captives. Say.
Read.
We have sinned.
We have what?
We have sinned.
We have sinned as a people. Come on.
And have done perversely.
And we have done perversely when it comes to the laws of God. Read.
We have committed wickedness.
We have committed wickedness. That is what the Lord wants. The Most High God wants us to acknowledge our offenses and repent. Hold this, give me Hosea chapter 5, verse 15. We're coming back here. Hosea chapter 5, verse 15. The Most High God wants us in the land of our captivity, we must bethink ourselves and repent. Okay? Hosea chapter 5, verse 15. Read what you got.
The book of Hosea, chapter 5, verse 15.
Read.
I will go and return to my place.
Now, this is the Lord speaking. He says he will go and return to his place. Okay? All this, Acts 1 and 9. He says, I will go and return to my place. This is when the Lord went and returned to his place. Okay, come on.
The book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 9.
Read.
And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight.
You see that thing? A cloud received him out of their sight. So when we read that again, verse 9. I want you brothers and sisters to pay attention here. Read again.
Book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 9.
Read.
And when he had spoken these things.
This is with this Christ now. When Christ spoke these things, read.
While they beheld.
While they were looking at him, come on.
He was taken up.
He was what?
He was taken up.
That's when he was what? That's when he went and returned to his place. Read.
And a cloud received him out of their sight.
A cloud received him out of their sight. Who? The apostles. You understand? The cloud received him out of their sight. Watch this. Give me that in Psalms. Okay? Give me that in Psalms. 103. 104 verse 3. I'm shooting from the hip. Okay?
The book of Psalms, chapter 104, verse 3.
Come on.
Who layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters?
That's it right there. Who layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters? Read.
Who maketh the clouds his chariot?
Who maketh the clouds his chariot? So the chariot is talking, the cloud is talking about the chariot. Today they call them UFOs. Read.
Who walketh upon the wings of the wind?
So that's what, that's it on that. Let's go back now to Hosea. Go back to Acts chapter 1 verse 9. Acts 1 and 9. Let's read that again.
The book of Acts chapter 1 verse 9.
Read.
And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight.
And a cloud received him out of their sight. Meaning what? He was taken up, he went into a chariot. You see that thing? He went into a chariot. Now go back to Hosea now. Now that we understand the thought, okay? Hosea chapter 5 verse 15.
The book of Hosea chapter 5 verse 15.
Read.
I will go and return to my place.
That's what we just read in Acts 1 and 9. He says, I will go and return to my place. Read.
Till they acknowledge their offense.
Till we, the children of Israel, in the land of our captivity, far from Jerusalem, near to Jerusalem. Read that part again. Till they what?
Till they acknowledge their offense.
Till we, the children of Israel, acknowledge our offenses. Because we must acknowledge our offense. Okay? That's why we are in here. So that the Lord has brought us in here to acknowledge our offenses. So we can repent. That's what the Lord wants. Read.
And seek my face.
We must seek the face of the Lord. Give me Hosea 3. Okay? Hosea chapter 3. Start at verse... let me see. Hosea chapter 3. And verse... Let me see. I'm shooting from the hip again. Okay? Give me Hosea chapter 4 and verse... it will come to me. Go back to where was that? Read Hosea 5:15 again.
The book of Hosea chapter 5 verse 15.
Read.
I will go and return to my place.
I will go and return to my place. Come on.
Till they acknowledge their offense.
Till we, the children of Israel, acknowledge our offenses. Read.
And seek my face.
We must seek the face of the Lord. The face of the Lord is this Bible. The face of the Most High God is this Bible. Watch this. Give me the book of Psalms 104. Okay? Psalms 104. Watch this. Give me Psalms 104 and verse 29. Psalms 104 verse 29. Okay? There's one in Hosea, but I'll use this one. Psalms 104 verse 29. Come on.
The book of Psalms chapter 104 verse 29.
Remember, in Hosea what we just read, it says, I will go and return to my place till they acknowledge their offense. And what? Till they acknowledge their offense in their affliction. They will seek me early. Read that part again. Read verse 29 now. Watch this.
Psalm chapter 104, verse 29.
Come on.
Thou hidest thy face.
You see what the Lord did? That's why Hosea says, and seek my face. In order for you to seek something, you have to do what? You must be searching for it. Because why? It's hidden. That's why it says, seek my face. Because the face of the Lord was hidden from us. in slavery. That's why it says, seek my face. Read that part again.
Psalm chapter 105, verse 29.
Read.
Thou hidest thy face.
The Lord hid his face from us. The Most High God, he hid his face from us. Why? Because we was wicked as hell. Read.
They are troubled.
They are troubled. They are what?
They are troubled.
We are troubled. How did we become troubled? We went into slavery. That's the trouble we found ourselves in. Read.
Thou takest away their breath.
You see that thing? The Lord took away our breath from us. He took away the laws from us. Because in the laws, there lies our identity. So he took everything from us. Why? Because we sinned against him. Read again.
Psalm chapter 104, verse 29.
Read.
Thou hidest thy face.
Thou hidest thy face. The Lord hid his face from us. Read.
They are troubled.
They are what?
They are troubled.
They are troubled. That's why now we are seeking the Most High God's face. We are seeking him early now because we are in trouble. Read.
Thou takest away their breath.
The Lord took away his breath from us. Read.
They die.
They what?
They die.
They die. Come on.
And return to their dust.
And return to their dust. Now we are in slavery. Okay? It says what? It says, the Lord, he says, thou takest away their breath. You understand? They die and return to their dust. Slavery, captivity. Okay? Give me that in Proverbs chapter 7, verse 2. You understand? Because it says, thou takest away their breath, they die. What is the breath that the Lord took from us? Okay? Watch this. Proverbs chapter 7, verse 2.
The book of Proverbs chapter 7, verse 2.
Come on.
Keep my commandments and live.
Keep my commandments and live. Keep my commandments and what?
Keep my commandments and live.
And live. And live. What gives us life? What is the breath of life? The laws of God. The commandments. You understand? Go back to where he was at.
Book of Psalm, chapter 104, verse 29.
Come on.
Thou hidest thy face.
The Lord hid his Bible from us. Read.
They are troubled.
We are troubled. We went into slavery. Come on.
Thou takest away their breath. They die.
You see that thing? The Lord took away his breath from us. We were spiritually dead. Proverbs 21, verse 16. Proverbs 21, verse 16. The Lord took away his breath from us. He took away his commandment from us, which gave us life. Okay? Read.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 21, verse 16. The man that wandereth out of the way of understanding.
The man that wandereth out of the way of understanding, what happens to them?
Shall remain in the congregation of the dead.
They shall remain in the congregation of the dead. Because right now, when the Lord took away his breath from us, what happened to us? We wandered in the congregation of the dead. Out of the way of understanding. Because we lost that understanding that the Lord gave to us. Okay? Read that part again.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 21, verse 16.
Read.
The man that wandereth out of the way of understanding.
The man that wandereth out of the way of understanding. The men and women of Israel. Read.
Shall remain in the congregation of the dead.
You see that thing? Go back to where it was at now. Psalms 104, verse 29 again.
The book of Psalms, chapter 104, verse 29.
Read.
Thou hidest thy face.
Uh-huh.
They are troubled.
We are troubled. Read.
Thou takest away their breath.
Uh-huh.
They die.
We wandered out of the way of understanding. So guess what happened to us? We ended up in the congregation of the dead. Read.
And returned to their dust.
They did what?
And returned to their dust.
We returned to our dust, meaning death. Spiritual death. Okay? That's what the Lord did. Go back to now who was where? Hosea chapter 5, verse 15.
The book of Hosea, chapter 5, verse 15. I will go and return to my place.
What did the Lord say?
I will go and return to my place.
God says he will go and return to his place. That's the Most High. Read.
Till they acknowledge their offense.
Till they, the children of Israel, acknowledge their offense. Read.
And seek my face.
And seek his face, meaning what? That means that his face is hidden from us. So we must seek his face, this Bible. Read.
In their affliction.
In their affliction, come on.
They will seek me early.
In their affliction, in trouble, we're going to seek the Lord early. You understand? We're going to get our act together. That's what he's saying. Because a lot of us, we tend to what? We'd be dragging our feet in this truth. Because we think, you think tomorrow is promised to you. Tomorrow is promised to nobody. So whatever chance you get, you better make sure that you praise the Lord your God. Give me that in 12:12, verse 10. Whatever chance you get, you praise the Lord your God. Okay? Tobit chapter 12. Start at verse 8. Tobit 12 verse 8.
The book of Tobit chapter 12 verse 8. Prayer is good with fasting and alms and righteousness.
Read.
A little with righteousness is better than much with unrighteousness.
Come on.
It is better to give alms than to lay up gold.
Now watch this. Jump up to verse 6. Read verse 6. That's what I want actually. Read verse 6.
Tobit chapter 12 verse 6. Then he took them both apart and said unto them, bless God, praise him, and magnify him, and praise him for the things which he hath done unto you in the sight of all that live.
Read verse 6 again.
The book of Tobit, chapter 12, verse 6. Then he took them both apart.
He took them both apart, come on.
And said unto them,
read.
Bless God.
Bless the Most High God.
Praise him.
Praise the Lord. Read.
And magnify him.
And magnify the Most High God with your good works. Read.
And praise him for the things which he had done unto you in the sight of all that live.
You see what he's saying? He says, praise him for the things which he had done for you in the sight of all that live. Meaning everybody must know that this sister right there, she's praising the Lord. This brother right here, he humbles down to what this Bible is saying. That is what the Most High God is saying here. You understand? Open your eyes, black man and black woman. Read again.
The book of Tobit, chapter 12, verse 6.
Read.
Then he took them both apart.
Come on.
And said unto them, bless God, praise him, and magnify him, and praise him for the things which he had done unto you in the sight of all that live.
In the sight of all that live. Read.
It is good to praise God.
It is what?
It is good to praise God.
It is good to praise God. Read.
And exalt his name.
And exalt his name. Read.
And honorably to show forth the works of God. Therefore, be not slack to praise him.
You see that thing? Be not slack to praise the Lord. That's what he's saying right there. Go back to Hosea 5 verse 15. Come on.
The book of Hosea chapter 5 verse 15.
Read.
I will go and return to my place.
I will go and return to my place. That's what we read in Acts 1 and 9. Read.
Till they acknowledge their offense.
Till we acknowledge our offense. Where? Where are we going to be in the last days? In the lands of our captivity. Serving hard bondage because of our sins. That's what he's saying right there. And I need you sisters to pay attention here. Okay? Read again.
The book of Hosea, chapter 5, verse 15.
Read.
I will go and return to my place.
Read.
Till they acknowledge their offense.
Come on.
And seek my face.
And seek my face. Read.
In their affliction, they will seek me early.
You see that thing right there? What Hosea is saying is the same thing that King Solomon is saying. Go back to 1 Kings, chapter 8, verse 47. First Kings 8:47.
Chapter 8, verse 47.
Read.
Yet if they shall bethink themselves.
If we shall bethink ourselves. Read.
In the land whither they were carried captives.
In the land where we were carried captives as slaves. Read.
And repent.
And what?
And repent.
And repent. That's the key to salvation. Right here. Read.
And make supplication unto thee. In the land of them that carried them captives.
You see that thing? We must make supplication. We must humble ourselves down in the land of our slavery. We must humble down to what this Bible is saying. Read that part again.
First book of Kings, chapter 8, verse 47.
Read.
Yet if they shall bethink themselves.
If they shall bethink themselves. Remember who they are. Read.
In the land whither they were carried captives.
In the land we was carried captives. Read.
And repent.
And repent. Read.
And make supplication unto thee for them of them that carried their captives.
Read, come on.
Say, we have sinned.
This is what the Lord wants us to say. He's even telling us what we must say because he knows Israel is slow. Okay? We have sinned. Read.
We have sinned and have done perversely.
We have perverted the laws of God. Read.
We have committed wickedness.
We have committed wickedness. That is what the Lord is looking for. Okay? The Most High God is looking for a contrite spirit. The Lord is looking for a brother and or sister that when they do wrong, when they apologize, they mean it. That's what the Lord is looking for. You understand? He's not looking for, I'm sorry, but you still be a demon again. The Lord is not looking for that thing. Because if we keep doing that, guess what's going to happen to you? The Lord will destroy you. So this right here is your protection. Understand that. Watch this. Give me that in Acts chapter 3 verse 19. Remember what he said? He says, we must repent in the land of our slavery. Read that. The book of Acts chapter 3 verse 19.
The book of Acts chapter 3 verse 19.
Read.
Repent ye therefore and be converted.
He says, repent and be converted. Read.
That your sins may be blotted out.
This is the benefit of repentance. That your sins may be blotted out. Read that part again.
The book of Acts chapter 3 verse 19.
Read.
Repent ye therefore and be converted.
He says, repent and be converted. Come on.
That your sins may be blotted out.
That your sins may be wiped out. Read.
When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord.
Before the Lord returns. You see what he's saying? Repent and be converted. What converts us? Give me that in Acts. Give me that in Psalms 19 verse 7. Psalms 19 verse 7. This is what converts the black man and the black woman. This is what's going to turn a boy into a man. This is what's going to turn a girl into a woman. You understand? A woman into a sister. A sister into a wife and a mother. Okay? Read what you got. Psalms 19 verse 7.
The book of Psalm chapter 19 verse 7.
Come on.
The law of the Lord is perfect.
The law of the Lord is perfect. Read.
Converting the soul.
Converting the soul. What converts us? Read the part again.
The law of the Lord is perfect.
That's what converts the black man and the black woman. That's how your sins are going to be blotted out when you repent. Because the laws of God is what's going to change you. That is what the Lord wants. The Bible is about change. This whole Bible is about change. You understand? Because in Israel, brothers, sisters, they be working on themselves, but there's no change. What's the problem? You're working on yourself, but the same thing keep coming up over and over. Why? Because you are not taking your work seriously. You're not making your calling and election sure. You're not studying. You're not applying. The Bible is not a book of what you just read and that's it. No, you read, you apply. You only apply when the Bible is closed. When you're out and about in the world, among brothers and sisters out there, the wicked of our people. That's when this Bible you're going to see the essence of it. Okay? Read that again.
The book of Psalm, chapter 19, verse 7.
Read.
The law of the Lord is perfect.
The law of the Lord is perfect. So what is King David teaching us here? He's teaching us that if you want to see perfection, keep the laws of God. Apply the laws of God if you want to see you mastering things that you are struggling with. The law. He's telling you what is perfect. God's laws is perfect. Okay? There's nothing wrong with the laws of God. Everything about God's commandments is perfect. Give me that in Psalms 119 verse 151. Okay? Psalms 119 verse 151. Watch this.
The book of Psalms, chapter 119, verse 151.
Come on.
Thou art near, O Lord, and all thy commandments are true.
You see that thing? All thy commandments are true. So if you believe that the laws of God is the truth, guess what you're going to do? You're going to understand now something that most black men and black women don't understand. That's how you reach your level of perfection in the spirit of Christ. And it's a process. But it's not going to happen. It's not going to fall on your lap. Don't nobody going to deliver it to you. You must labor to get it. You must show the Lord that you are worthy to receive it. You understand? Read again.
The book of Psalms, chapter 119, verse 151.
Read.
Thou art near, O Lord.
Come on.
And all thy commandments are true.
And some of thy commandments are true.
And all thy commandments are true.
And all thy commandments are true. All thy commandments are true. Meaning what? They are perfect. Go back to Psalms 19, verse 7.
The book of Psalms, chapter 19, verse 7.
Read.
The law of the Lord is perfect.
The laws of God are perfect. They are true. Read.
Converting the soul.
That's what's going to change you. The whole Bible is about change. You understand? You cannot hold on to that nigger man. You cannot hold on to that nigger woman. Them days are over. You must kill him or kill her. Read that part again.
Psalm 19, verse 7.
Come on.
The law of the Lord is perfect.
Read.
Converting the soul.
Converting the soul. That's what's going to change your thinking. Okay? Read.
The testimony of the Lord is sure.
The testimony of the Lord is doubtful.
The testimony of the Lord is sure.
The testimony of the Lord is sure. You understand that? It's sure. There's, listen, everything about God's command, this is, the Bible is a reflection of the Most High. This whole Bible is a reflection of the Heavenly Father. So when you play with this, guess what? You are playing with your Father which is in heaven. This Bible is the body of Christ. Understand it. Okay? Read it again.
Book of Psalm, chapter 19, verse 7.
Because we read this all the time, you just glaze over it. Yes, the laws, it's like you're a carol. You're just reciting it. But you need to sink your spirit into this book. Read it again.
The book of Psalm, chapter 19, verse 7.
Come on.
The law of the Lord is perfect.
The law. Read.
Converting the soul.
Uh-huh.
The testimony of the Lord is sure.
Read.
Making wise the simple.
The testimony of the Lord is sure. Is sure. You understand? Making wise the simple. Give me that in 2 Peter. Okay? Is it 2 Peter 1:19? 2 Peter. Give me that thing. The testimony of the Lord is sure. Making wise the simple. Give me that thing. 2 Peter 1 verse 19. That's it right there. Watch this.
The book of 2 Peter, chapter 1, verse 19.
Come on.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy.
The more sure word of prophecy is Jesus the Christ, the Black Messiah. He's the more sure word of prophecy. Okay, come on.
Whereunto ye do well, that ye take heed.
That ye what?
That ye take heed.
You see that word right there? You must take heed. Meaning what? Beware. That's why when you go into somebody's house, you see there's a sign outside. They say, beware, there's dogs in here. Meaning if you jump the fence or you go in, you might get bit. So what is the Lord saying? He says, take heed. Because if you don't apply what is written, if you don't think that this is a more sure word of prophecy, guess what's going to happen to you? You will be overcome. There's no if or maybe about it. Okay, come on.
As unto a light that shineth in a dark place.
You're going to be that light that shineth in a dark place. Why? Because the laws of God is with you. Give me that in Proverbs. Okay, chapter 6, verse 23. Proverbs 6, verse 23. Watch this. We're coming back here. Proverbs 6, verse 23.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 6, verse 23.
Read.
For the commandment is a lamp.
The commandment of God is a lamp. There's that word again. The commandments, the law. Read.
And the law is light.
And the law, and what?
And the law. Is light.
And the law is light. The law is light. So guess what? When you believe that this is a more sure word of prophecy, you take heed, you do well. You're gonna be that light that shines in a dark place. Because the laws of God will be shown through you. You're gonna be that example to show, to prove that this Bible is true. You're gonna be that vessel that the Lord will use to what? To channel his glory in. The choice is yours. It's up to you. Read it again.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 6, verse 23.
Come on.
For the commandment is a lamp.
Come on.
And the law is light.
Read.
And reproofs of instruction are the way of life.
And reproofs. Reproofs of instructions. The reproofs of instructions is the way of life. Where do you get the reproofs of instruction? The laws of God. The only place where you're going to get reproofs of instruction is out of God's laws. That's what he's saying right there. Okay? Go back to where he was at.
2nd book of Peter. 1st Peter.
2nd Peter 1 verse 19.
2nd Peter chapter 1 verse 19.
Come on.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy.
Read.
Whereunto ye do well, that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place.
You're going to be that light, that law, the laws of God will be seen through you. You're going to prove this Bible to be real. You're going to prove the Bible to be a real book when you apply. Real.
Until the day dawn, and the day star arise in your heart.
That day star that will arise in your heart is Jesus the Christ. He's the day star, he's that star. He is the star of wisdom, okay, that will arise in your mind to give you wisdom. That is what the Apostle Peter is teaching us here. I need you men and women to pay attention, okay? Because this class is not supposed to be one of those classes where one year after other. That's why we're celebrating the Feast of Pentecost, the Feast of First Fruits, where you become that fruit. So you need to ask yourself, are you going to be the fruit that will be desired for somebody to want to eat of the fruit? The choice is yours. Okay? You make that decision. Whether you believe it, you are correct. Whether you don't believe it, you are true. You are correct as well. Because at the end of the day, you will produce fruit. The question is, what type of fruit is it going to be? Okay? That's your decision. Watch this. Go back to Psalms 19, verse 7. Now that we understand what King David was teaching us in the Spirit of Christ, now we have a much better understanding of what this verse is saying. Okay, Psalms 19, verse 7 again.
The book of Psalms, chapter 19, verse 7.
Read.
The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul.
Come on.
The testimony of the Lord is sure, making the wise is simple.
Because it's a fact that we are simple as hell when we don't have the laws of God. That's what he's saying right there. Making wise the simple. So is this an opinion or a fact? This is a fact. Making wise the simple. That means we are the simple ones. That means what? That means the laws of God to receive the wisdom. You see, that thing is very plain to understand. Okay, let's go back to Acts now. Chapter 3, verse 19.
The book of Acts, chapter 3, verse 19.
Read.
Repent ye therefore and be converted.
It says, repent and be converted. You see that thing? Repent and be converted. What's going to convert us? The laws of God. When you allow the laws of God to change you, guess what? You have a more sure word of prophecy. Where you're going to do well, and in your walk, you will take heed to the things you say and do. To the decisions you make, they are going to be filtered through this Bible. Because you're going to take heed. What is the caution that you want to take? If I mess up here, if I keep repeating the same thing over and over, the Lord will do away with me. So, but a lot of us, we don't do that. We don't take thought about that thing because we think we're still moving in that Christian spirit. You see that thing, Father, forgive me. Yeah, I messed up last night. Father, forgive me. But there's no change. The Most High God wants change. That's what he's looking for. You understand? Because when we have counsels and all that, there's a lot of stuff that they just keep coming up over and over. I'm like, what the hell is this? You know why? Men and women, you don't take this thing seriously as you should. Or you don't take it as seriously as you thought you are taking it serious. Because it's only going to be proved in your application and the results of your quote-unquote application. Because if you apply, you will see results. If you don't apply, this is not a book where you can fake it till you make it. No, it doesn't work like that. Either you do it or you don't do it, but the results will show. It's that simple. You understand? You cannot come some other way. The only way you're going to come to the Father is through his Bible. His instruction. His reproofs of instruction. Everybody get that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, all praises. Read that again, verse 19.
Acts chapter 3, verse 19.
Read.
Repent ye therefore and be converted.
Come on.
That your sins may be blotted out.
That your sins may be blotted out. This is the benefit of repentance right here. That your sins, the laws that you'll be breaking, may be forgiven of you. You understand? But you're not going to receive forgiveness if you don't repent. And if you say you repent, you must be applying the laws of God. And guess what? Must come after that. Change. Change must happen. Because if there's no change, you are not applying. Everybody get this?
Yes, sir.
If there's no change, you are not applying this Bible. Yes, you read it. Yes, you make notes. Yes, you quote-unquote study, but you are not applying because there's no change. So what's the problem? Because, listen, if you go to work, you believe that you're going to get paid. Why? Because you're working. Right? So if you keep the commandments, it means you believe you will get the kingdom. But if you don't keep the commandments, you don't believe that you're going to receive the kingdom. But when it comes to work, there's no confusion. You see what I'm saying? So what does that mean? This book is not believed. That's some heavy stuff. Pay attention, black men. Sisters,
Today is your day. Brothers, today is your glorious day. All praises. Read that thing again, verse 19. Watch this.
Acts chapter 3, verse 19.
Read.
Repent ye therefore and be converted.
Come on.
That your sins may be blotted out.
That your sins may be blotted out. To blot out means what? To be wiped out. Okay, watch this. Give me Psalm 51, verse 1. Psalm 51, verse 1. I'm going to be moving a little faster now. Okay, Psalm 51, verse 1.
Psalm chapter 51, verse 1.
Come on.
Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness.
Read.
According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgression.
You see what King David is doing? He's begging for mercy. You understand that? He's begging for the Lord to give him mercy in the day of judgment. Because yes, when you do wrong, you ask for forgiveness, the Lord will forgive you. But don't think there's not going to be judgment. Judgment is still coming. But guess what? The Lord will, you must beg the Lord to, when he deals with you on that day, he must what? Extend mercy unto you. You understand? That's why you must have a contrite spirit. You must have a sorrowful mind. That's what the Lord is looking for. Because you can lie with your lips, but when it comes to your mind, you'll be thinking other things. You're not really sorry, okay? But you say it with your lips, but your actions don't equal what you're saying. So that means you're not coming to the Most High God with a what? With a heavy heart. Read again.
Psalm chapter 51, verse 1.
Read.
Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness.
Read.
According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies.
Read.
Blot out my transgressions.
Blot out my transgression. So King David is begging the Most High. Because what is he doing? He's repenting. He wants his sins to be blotted out. That's what we read in the book of Acts. Read.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity.
You see what it's saying? Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. How is David going to do that? Psalms 119 verse 9. He says, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. You know what? Finish verse 2. Finish verse 2. Then we're going to go to Psalms 119 verse 9. I'm getting my head over myself here. Okay. Read that again. Verse 2.
The book of Psalms 51 verse 2.
Read.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sins.
You see that thing? And cleanse me from my sins. Psalms 119 verse 9 now. Watch this.
The book of Psalms, chapter 119 verse 9.
Come on.
Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way?
Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? A young man or young woman? A man or a woman? Sons and daughters? How are we going to cleanse our sons and our daughters that come into this truth? Read.
By taking heed thereto according to thy word.
That's how you're going to cleanse your ways. That's how the Lord is going to be able to wash you thoroughly from your sins, from your wickedness. When you apply, that's how you're going to wash yourself with God's laws. Go back to where was that? Psalm 61 verse 2.
The book of Psalm chapter 51 verse 2.
Come on.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity.
Read.
And cleanse me from my sin.
How does he do that? With the word. He washes you with the word. Ephesians 5:26. The Lord will wash you with his word. All you have to do is what? Is believe that it will wash you, and guess what? You will be washed when you apply. Ephesians 5:26. Come on, come on.
The book of Ephesians, chapter 5, verse 26.
Come on.
That he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word.
You see that thing? The same thing that the Apostle Paul is saying here is the same thing that King David is saying. You understand? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. That's how you're going to be washed. Don't nobody gonna dip anybody in a pool of water. That's not happening here. The pool of water you're gonna be dipped in is the laws of God. You see that thing? If you want to be washed with the pool, dipped in a pool of water, go to the Christian church. They will wash you thoroughly with that thing, chlorine. They will wash you until you turn, they will bleach you. Chlorine is a bleach. They will bleach you, okay? But not in Israel. In Israel, you're going to be washed with the word. Understand that? Sister Chloe, we don't even go anywhere near that. Okay? Go back to where was that? Psalm 61 verse 2 again.
The book of Psalm chapter 51 verse 2.
Read.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity.
Come on.
And cleanse me from my sin.
Next verse. Watch this.
For I acknowledge my transgression.
You see that thing right there? That's what we read in Hosea. I know some of you forgotten already. Read again.
Book of Psalm chapter 51 verse 3.
Read.
For I acknowledge my transgression.
He says, I acknowledge my transgressions. The laws that are broken, O Lord. Read.
And my sin is ever before me.
You see that thing? Your sin is ever before you. How is your sin ever before you? How are you going to be reminded about the sins that you used to commit? Watch this. Give me Romans 7. Romans 7 verse 7. This is why he's saying my sin is ever before me. Okay? Because it will keep coming back when you don't apply. But Satan also, he visits you in season. To see, did you perfect that? Did you put an armor around that? Did you cover your head? You understand? Did you put on the whole armor? Because he comes in seasons. That's why your sins keep coming up over and over. Because Satan will come on, he will visit you in season. So on that day when you least expect it, he's gonna appear, he's gonna pay you a visit. So when you are not in the Bible on a daily basis, guess what's going to happen? You're focusing on, okay, I'm struggling with what? Let's say I'm struggling with Tom. But you are busy reading about the seven heads of the dragon. When the day he visits you, guess what? Yeah, you're going to know that, the seven heads of the dragon. But now, you see where he's going to take you? He's going to take you on the porn side of things. Last. Because you didn't cover that. Okay, let's say you cover that, but you are struggling with lying. Okay, then you focus on this, but you don't deal with lying. Because you don't examine yourself, so you don't know, or rather, you don't take seriously the fact that you have a spirit of a lie. Now, Satan is saying, okay, I'm going to put you in a situation now. Let's see whether you will tell the truth or you're going to lie. Guess what? You covered the last issue because you are dealing with porn, but guess what? Now you are in a situation now where you must tell the truth. And you telling the truth is going to make you seem, is going to expose you. So what you going to do? You tell the truth, but guess what? When you don't apply, you won't do it. When you apply, you're not going to do it. When you apply, you will not do it. You know what you're going to do? You're going to say, no, but, you know, I had to. I didn't have a choice. That's what you're going to do. You're going to say, no, I had to. I didn't have a choice, and so forth and so on. That's what you're going to do. Why? Guess what? Satan got you. You see, that's how he catches you. Okay? Read that thing again. Read verse 7 now. Romans 7 verse 7. This is how he says, my sin is ever before me. This is what it means.
The book of Romans, chapter 7, verse 7.
Come on.
What shall we say then?
Read.
Is the law sin?
Is the law sin?
God forbid.
Meaning, no. The law is not sin. Read.
Nay. I had not known sin.
I had not known sin. Read.
But by the law.
You see that thing? So the laws of God is going to teach you about what? The sins you are in. Not only that, it will remind you. No, that's wrong right there. That verse says, my sin is ever before me. How? Because you are applying the law. The law is what? It's going to help you to be aware of your sins. It's going to help you to be aware of the things that you know you struggle with. But if you're not in the law, how are you going to be able to know the sins that are before you? Or the what? The dangers that your flesh is struggling with. How are you going to know that? You're not going to know until you grow into this Bible. You are not going to know, because whenever I read, I get cut all the time. Why? Because you need to sit down and say, I'm really dealing with this. The Lord is showing you something. But some of you ignore it. You say, no, it's not me. You're getting cut, but you are in denial. You believe in the Bible, you're getting cut left, right, and center. But guess what? You are in denial. No, it's not me. After you read it, when you were reading it, it cuts you. You start to avoid certain books in the Bible. Because when you read it, you start to realize, this is reminding me of the evil that I am. It's reminding me of the wickedness that's in my spirit. So I'm not going to read that all the time. Yeah, I'd rather focus on this one. Some people will be even buying a black marker to black it out. You know what I'm saying? Just so that you don't have to acknowledge the fact that, listen, I'm getting cut out here. That's the mind of the Negro. But when you get cut, that's where you really should focus on. You focus on all your attention. When you get cut, listen, when you read the Bible, you don't get cut no more, you should be worried. Because you can convince yourself and say, no, I'm over that. That's why I don't get cut no more. Because the mind can deceive you and say, no, but I don't get cut. It's also, that's that pertains to me. Mm-hmm. You are deceiving yourself. And it's very easy to deceive yourself. Don't deceive yourself, brothers and sisters. Okay? Watch this. Give me, where was we at?
Romans 7 verse 7.
Go back to Psalm 61 verse 3. That's why we went over there. Okay, come on.
Psalm chapter 51 verse 3.
Read.
For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me.
You see that thing? I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. So why? Because the Lord, he was applying God's commandments in his life. So now he was always reminded, that's wrong. Why? Because he's applying. You understand? Only when you apply, you're going to know what is wrong and what is right. Watch this. Give me the book of Psalms 32 verse 5. Psalms chapter 32 verse 5. Okay?
The book of Psalms chapter 32 verse 5.
Remember, we are going all to all these precepts to do what? To explain what King Solomon is saying. That we must repent in the lands of our captivity and give supplication unto the Lord in the land wherein he carried away captive and repent. You understand? Read that.
The book of Psalm chapter 82 verse 5.
Come on.
I acknowledge my sin unto thee.
You see that thing? I acknowledge my sin unto thee. All this 1 John 3 and 4. He says, I acknowledge my sin unto thee. I acknowledge my sin unto thee. Here's another thing. I see some brothers and sisters don't know how to take notes. Okay? So you just writing a scripture and just listening to me talk, you're not going to understand what's coming out. Yes, write the scripture because you can always reference it in the Bible. The thing that you must do is write the explanations next to the scripture. Okay? Don't be looking at me. Read them. What is the same one?
First John.
1 John 3 and 4. Read what you got.
First book of John chapter 3 verse 4.
Read.
Whosoever committed sin transgresses also the law.
Whosoever commits sin transgresses also the law. Go ahead.
For sin is the transgression of the law.
You see what sin is? Sin is the breaking of God's laws. Now let's go back. Watch this. Psalm 32 verse 5 again.
The book of Psalm chapter 32 verse 5.
Come on.
I acknowledge my sin.
I acknowledge my sin unto thee. Meaning, Father, I acknowledge the fact that I've broken your laws. Read.
And my iniquity have I not hid.
Because some of you are hiding your sins from the Lord. Some of you are hiding your sins from the Most High God. And you think the Lord is just going to hear you. You come to the Lord, you try to present yourself as this one. You are presenting yourself as this, my ish don't stink. You're focusing, you're giving the, you're presenting yourself to the Lord with these nice prayers. But you don't really want to tell the Lord what's really going on. You don't want to say to the Lord, Father, I'm struggling. Okay? I'm struggling with this thing. Help me. You don't want to say that. You'll be saying all these nice things. No, the Lord don't want that. The Most High God wants you to say exactly what is in the mind that's troubling you. That you cannot tell any of us. Okay? Yes, you can lie to yourself. You can lie to me, but you can't lie to the Most High. Your job is to confess directly to the Lord, not to me, to the Heavenly Father, and tell him, Father, I have this spirit, I'm struggling with it. I have that spirit, I'm struggling with it. Help me. What must I do? Guess what's going to happen? Guess what? How the Lord will answer you. The Lord is not going to come down yet. The class will come out and we'll address that issue. That's how it's going to happen. The Most High is not going to come down here and talk to you special, directly. Not how he's used the prophets to do it, out the Bible as it is written. That's how it goes down. Read again.
Psalm chapter 32 verse 5.
Read.
I acknowledge my sin unto thee.
I acknowledge my sin unto thee. Read.
And my iniquity have I not hid.
And my iniquity have I not hid. So don't hide your sins from the Most High. Read.
I said, I will confess my transgressions. I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
You see, don't be hiding that stuff. You must tell the Lord what you are dealing with, what you are struggling with, what's troubling you. Read.
And thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin.
That's when the Lord will forgive you. The Lord will forgive you when you do stuff like that. Read.
Selah.
You see what it said? So now, watch this. Give me the book of 1 Kings. Go back to 1 Kings 8, 47. 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 47.
1 book of Kings, chapter 8, verse 47.
Read.
Yet if they shall bethink themselves in the land whither they were carried captives, and repent.
And do what?
And repent.
And repent. Go ahead.
And make supplication unto thee in the land of them that carried them captives, say, we have sinned.
We have sinned.
And have done perversely.
And have done perversely. Go ahead.
We have committed wickedness.
We have committed wickedness. That is what the Lord wants. We went to all these precepts to understand what the Lord commanded us to say. How he commanded us how to pray and what to say, because we make dumb prayers. So the Lord is saying, listen, instead of making dumb prayers, let me tell you what you want to say. You want to say this exactly, and then I'm going to hear you. And you're going to do exactly as it is written, based on how I commanded you, how you must come to me. You're not going to come to me based on how you want, how you feel in your heart. I'm going to tell you exactly what you're going to say, and you're going to execute it exactly. Because we're dealing with the Most High. He is the Father. Okay? Read that part again, verse 47. This is a heavy verse right here. Read.
Chapter 8, verse 47.
Go ahead.
Yet if they shall bethink themselves in the land whither they were carried captives.
Read.
And repent.
And repent. Repent. Because when you repent and be converted, what happens? Your sins are blotted out. That's what happens. Read.
And make supplication unto thee in the land of them that carried them captives, saying, we have sinned.
We have sinned.
And have done perversely.
And we have done perversely.
We have committed wickedness.
We have committed wickedness. Watch this. Give me the book of Baruch now. Baruch chapter 2, verse 30. Baruch 2. Okay? Baruch was Jeremiah's scribe. Listen to what he says when we were slaves in Babylon. Okay? Watch this. Baruch chapter 2, verse 30. Watch this.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 30.
Come on.
Baruch, chapter 2, verse 30.
Read.
For I knew that they would not hear me.
This is the Lord speaking through Jeremiah. He says, I knew, because I knew that they are not going to hear me. Okay, come on.
Because it is a stiff-necked people.
Because it's a rebellious people. He says, the reason why I'm sending you in captivity is because I know that if I talk to you nicely, come on, little no, guess what? You're not going to hear nothing. But if I put some fire behind, if set fire on your behind, guess what's going to happen to you? You're going to be in order. That is what he said right there. Read again.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 30.
Come on.
For I knew that they would not hear me, because it is a stiff-necked people. But in the land of their captivities, they shall remember themselves.
Read that again.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 30.
Read.
For I knew that they would not hear me.
He says, I knew that they would not hear me. Read.
Because it is a stiff-necked people.
Because it is a stiff-necked people. Read.
But in the land of their captivities.
But in the lands of their captivities, come on.
They shall remember themselves.
They shall what?
They shall remember themselves.
We will bethink ourselves. That's what he's saying right there. You see what he's saying? He says, I knew that they were not going to hear what I'm saying. But in the lands of their captivity, they shall remember themselves. How are we going to remember ourselves? How are we going to remember who we are? Because the Lord will do what? He will bring forth judgment on us. Then when we are in affliction, you understand? When we are catching hell, then we're going to remember the Lord. You know what? The Most High was right. You understand? Now you're going to remember the Bible now. You say, you know, my father was right about this thing. Now you're getting yourself together. Because the only way the black man will get himself together, because he knows, well, like donkeys. Very stubborn, hard-headed, you understand, and rebellious. You understand? Read that again.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 30.
Read.
For I knew that they would not hear me.
He says, I knew that they would not hear me. I knew that my children were not going to listen to me. Read.
Because it is a stiff-necked people.
Because it is a stiff-necked people, because they are rebellious. Read.
But in the land of their captivities, they shall remember themselves.
But in the lands of their captivities, they shall remember who they are. Read.
And shall know that I am the Lord their God.
And we shall know that he is the Lord our God. Read.
For I will give them a heart and ears to hear.
You see what he's saying? He says, because I'm going to give them a heart and an ears to hear. Once we caught hell, the Lord says, then I'm going to give you an ear, I'm going to give you a heart to receive my laws, and I'm going to make sure that your mind is in order. The only way for us to receive that, the Lord says, I'm going to set fire on you. Then you're going to hear me. You see what I'm saying? Read that again. Verse 31.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 81.
Come on.
And shall know that I am the Lord their God, for I will give them a heart and ears to hear.
Read.
And they shall praise me in the land of their captivity.
They shall praise me in the land. Hold on, wait. Read verse 31 again. There's something I want out of that verse.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 31.
Read.
And shall know that I am the Lord their God.
We're going to know that he is the Lord our God. Come on.
For I will give them a heart and ears to hear.
The Lord says he's going to give us a mind and an ears to hear. Spiritual eyes. Okay? You understand? No, spiritual ears and a what? And a mind that will receive correction. The mind that will receive the reproofs of the Lord. Watch this. Give me Ezekiel 36, 26. Ezekiel 36, verse 26. Watch this. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 36, verse 26.
That's what the Lord is doing, right now. The most that God is doing, what we are reading right now, that's exactly what we want right now. Okay, Ezekiel 36, 26, come on.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 36, verse 26.
Read.
A new heart also will I give you.
You see what the Lord is saying? A new heart, which is what? A mind. He says, a new mind also will I give unto you. Read.
And a new spirit will I put within you.
You see that thing? And a new spirit will I put within you. Which spirit is that? The spirit of Christ. Read.
And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh.
You see that thing? I'm going to take away from you the stony heart. Meaning what? A stubborn heart. A rebellious mind. That's what he's saying right there. That's what he says. I knew they're not going to hear me if I speak to them, if I cuddle them. I need to put them through slavery, colonization, forced migration, apartheid, Jim Crow. Then they will hear me. You see what I'm saying? Read it again.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 36, verse 26.
Come on.
A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you.
The spirit to do what? The spirit to humble down and apply what this Bible is saying. Read.
And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh.
Meaning what? Our rebellious spirit. Come on.
And I will give you a heart of flesh.
You see what it's saying? I will give you a heart of flesh. That's what it says. I'm going to give you a heart and an ears to hear. Next verse.
And I will put my spirit within you.
You see what it's saying? And I will put my spirit within you. What spirit is that? Give me that in John 6:63. It says, I will put my spirit within you. Let's see what that spirit is. Okay, come on.
The book of John, chapter 6, verse 63.
Read.
It is the spirit that quickeneth.
It is the spirit that changes you. The word quickeneth means change. Come on.
The flesh profits you nothing.
The flesh profits you nothing. Read.
The words that I speak unto you.
The words that Christ spoke unto us. They are what?
They are spirit.
They are spirit. Come on.
And they are life.
You see that thing? That new spirit is the spirit of Christ. To receive the word. You understand? And apply it. To bethink ourselves. To remember who we are. You see what I'm saying? Go back to where he was at.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 86, verse 27.
Read.
And I will put my spirit within you.
I'm going to put my spirit within you. The word, the laws. You shall know the truth. You shall know the law. And the law shall make you free. That's the new spirit that the Lord says he will put within us. Because we forgot that. Read.
And cause you to walk in my statutes.
You see that thing? And I'm going to cause you to walk in my statutes. How did he do that? He raised up men in the last day to go to the street corners to bring Israel in. Read.
And ye shall keep my judgments. And do them.
And what?
And do them.
No, and just think about them.
And do them.
And do them. Listen, you are reading Bible prophecy. Don't sleep, brothers and sisters. Okay? Go back to Baruch 2, verse 31.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 81.
Come on.
And shall know that I am the Lord their God.
How are we going to know that? How are we going to know that he is the Lord our God? 1 John 2, verse 3. This is how we know. Okay? The only way to know the Most High God, the Lord has laid it out in the Bible, so we know. 1 John 2, verse 3. It says, and ye shall know that I am the Lord your God. How are we going to know? This is how you're going to know black man. This is how you're going to know black woman. Watch this.
1 John chapter 2, verse 3.
Come on.
And hereby we do know that we know him.
Hereby we do know. We do know that we know him. The Most High God, come on.
If we
if that's the stipulation right there. If, come on.
If we keep his commandments.
If we keep God's commandments. Next verse.
He that says, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar.
Come on.
And the truth is not in him.
You see that thing right there? Next verse. Go ahead.
But whoso keepeth his word.
But whoso keepeth his word. The new spirit that will put within us. That's the word. Read.
In him, verily, is the love of God perfected.
You see the perfection? That's the perfection right there. That's the same thing we read in Psalms 19, verse 7. Read that verse again.
Verse John chapter 2, verse 5.
Come on.
But whoso keepeth his word.
But whoso keepeth his word. The law of the Lord is perfect. Go ahead.
In him, verily, is the love of God perfected.
Because the love of God is going to be perfected when you keep his word. Because the laws of God is perfect, converting the soul. That's the precept to Psalm 19, verse 7. Read.
Hereby know we that we are in him.
You see that thing? We know that we are in Christ and he in us. When we do what? When we apply what is written. That's some heavy stuff right there. Go back to Baruch 2, verse 31. Again.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 31.
Read.
And shall know that I am the Lord their God.
And we shall know. How are we going to know him? Because we keep his commandments. Because in the Christian church, we did not know the Lord. How did we know him? We didn't. We did not know the Lord in the Christian church because they did not teach us the law. The word of God was not in us. And he was not in us. We were not in him. Now when you come in Israel, they teach you the law. They teach you who you are, your true identity, your nationality. Then you know the Lord. And guess what? When you know the Lord, you know yourself too. You see, that's the benefit across the board. You understand? Chiefly because unto them was committed the oracles of God. You understand? That's some heavy stuff right there. Read again, verse 31.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 81.
Read.
And shall know that I am the Lord their God.
We shall know that he is the Lord our God because we keep his laws. Read.
For I will give them an heart.
I will give them an heart. That's what we read in Ezekiel 36. Read.
And ears to hear.
And ears to hear. That's why we have, that's why we, every man and woman is in here. Because the Lord is giving you an heart and an ears to hear. Okay? Go ahead.
And they shall praise me in the land of their captivity.
We shall do what?
We shall praise him in the land of their captivity.
And we shall praise the Lord in the land of our captivity. We will praise the Lord in the lands of our captivity. How are we going to praise the Lord? We're going to find out. Read.
And think upon my name.
We do and do what?
And think upon my name.
And we're going to think upon the name of the Lord. Because this is something that is, this is what came out yesterday when we was at camp. This black ashy demon sister came up to camp and said, no, but the name. No, the name Jesus is this, is Zeus. The hell is this? You're worshiping the wrong God. This is what Eve was coming with to Adam. We was just seeing a replay of what happened in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. Eve coming with doctrines and demonic philosophies to Adam. That's the same thing that sister was doing this day. Read again.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2, verse 82.
Come on.
And they shall praise me in the land of their captivity.
Read.
And think upon my name.
And think upon his name. Let's get the name. Give me that in Revelation 19, verse 13. Let's get the name of the Lord. Okay, because our people don't believe this Bible. Revelation 19, verse 13. Let's get the name of the Lord. Okay?
The book of Revelation, chapter 19, verse 13.
Read.
And he was clothed with a vesture deep in blood.
Let's talk about Christ. Read.
And his name.
His what?
His name.
His what?
His name.
His name, come on.
Is called the Word of God.
You see that thing? His name is called the Word of God. So when he says we will think upon his name, we will think upon his commandments, because when we do, that's how we know him. That's what we read in 1 John 2, verse 3 through 5. Okay? That's how we're going to know him. That's the name of the Lord right there. But our people don't believe this. You understand? Give me that in 2 Timothy, chapter 2, verse 19. 2 Timothy 2, verse 19. Okay? Because they are worried about the name, but they don't want to do what we're about to read. We just read about what the name of the Lord is. His name is called the Word of God. Watch this. 2 Timothy 2, verse 19. Watch this.
2 Book of Timothy, chapter 2, verse 19.
Go ahead.
Nevertheless, the foundation of God stands sure.
The foundation of God stands sure. That's the same thing we read in 2 Peter. Okay, come on.
Having this seal.
Having this what?
Having this seal.
The seal, give me that in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 16. Isaiah 8, verse 16. Having this seal, the foundation of God stands sure. Who's the foundation of the Lord? Jesus the Christ. Okay? Isaiah chapter 8, verse 16. Watch this.
Isaiah. Chapter 8, verse 16.
Go ahead.
Bind up the testimony.
And
seal the law.
Do what?
Seal the law.
Seal the law. Seal the law. Come on.
Among my disciples.
Seal the law among my disciples. Because the disciples will be disciplined in God's laws. That's why the laws of God is sealed in them. That's why they are called disciples. Because you, brothers and sisters, you are disciples. Okay? Go back to where was that now?
Second book of Timothy. Chapter 2, verse 19.
Read.
Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure.
The foundation of God standeth sure. That's Jesus the Christ. Give me Ephesians 2, verse 18, real quick. Okay, the foundation of God standeth sure. Let's see who's the foundation. Okay, Ephesians 2, start at verse 19.
The book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse 19.
Come on.
Now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners.
We are no more strangers and foreigners, because when we was in the Christian church, when we was in Islam and politics, democracy, that crazy demon, yet listen, we were strangers and foreigners. Really.
But fellow citizens.
But now we are fellow citizens. We are fellow citizens now. We understand who we are. We know where we come from and what happened to us. Really.
But
fellow citizens with the saints. Read.
And of the household of God.
We are the household of God. Read.
And are built upon the foundation of the apostles.
We are built up upon the foundation of the apostles. Read.
And prophets. Jesus Christ himself.
Come on.
Being the chief cornerstone.
You see that thing? Christ is the foundation. Christ is the chief cornerstone. He is the foundation. That is what we're reading right here. Okay, come on. Okay, that's it on that. Go back to where it was at.
Second book of Timothy, chapter 2, verse 19.
Read.
Nevertheless, the foundation of God stands sure.
The foundation of God stands sure. That's Jesus the Christ, the Black Messiah. Read.
Having this seal.
Having this seal, the law. Seal the law among my disciples. That's the seal he's making reference to. Go ahead.
The Lord knoweth them that are his.
The Lord knoweth them that are his. How does he know them that are his? Because they keep the commandments. They follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. How do we follow Christ? We keep his laws. Read.
And let everyone that nameth the name of Christ.
That's the name right there. Let everyone that nameth the name of Christ. Each and every one of you in here, you are naming the name of Christ. What is the name of the Lord? His commandments. Read.
Depart from iniquity.
We must depart from iniquity. You see how simple that is? If you name the name of the Lord, you must depart from iniquity. The sister didn't want to name the name of the Lord because she did not want to depart from iniquity. You see that thing? It's that simple. You see? It's very simple. Go back to Baruch 2 verse 31.
The book of Baruch, chapter 2 verse 31.
Read.
And shall know that I am the Lord thy God.
No, read verse 32. I'm sorry, verse 32. Come on.
Baruch chapter 2, verse 32.
Read.
And they shall praise me in the land of their captivity.
We shall praise the Lord in the lands of our captivities. Come on.
And think upon my name.
And we will think upon his name. What is his name? The Word of God. That's his name. Okay, watch this. How are we going to do that? Give me that in Judges 5, verse 11. It says, we shall praise his name in the lands of our captivity. We are in the lands of our captivity right now. We are in South Africa. You understand? Calling ourselves Bantus. No, no. We are Israelites. We are Jews. Okay? Read what you got. Judges 5 verse 11. Come on.
Judges chapter 5 verse 11. They that are delivered from the noise of the ashes.
No, no, read that line. Come on, come on.
The book of Judges chapter 5 verse 11.
Read.
They that are delivered from the noise of archers.
They that are delivered from the noise of archers. The noise, an archer is the one. This is not talking about a regular bow and arrow. Because a regular bow and arrow doesn't make noise. So he's not talking about it. He's talking about a missile. You understand? He's talking about a nuclear bomb. Read.
They that are delivered from the noise of ashes in the places of drawing water.
In the places of drawing water. What does that mean, in the places of drawing water? Give me the book of Joshua chapter 9 verse 21. In the places of drawing water. Okay? They that are delivered in the noise of ashes in the places of drawing water. Watch this. Come on.
The book of Joshua chapter 9 verse 21.
Now at this point, Joshua was putting the nations in fear and in check. At the hand of the Most High. You understand? We were conquering. You understand? We were putting fear on the Canaanites, the Amorites, the Hivites, the Jebusites. Okay? Read that.
The book of Joshua, chapter 9, verse 21.
Read.
And the princes said unto them.
The princes now, the princes, that's the Lord, the leaders of Israel, the captains. Go ahead.
Let them live.
Let them live. Let who live? The Canaanites? You understand? The Jebusites. We're going to get into that just for a second. Read.
But let them be hewers of wood.
Let them be hewers of wood. Come on.
And drawers of water.
And what?
And drawers of water.
Let them be hewers of wood and drawers of water. You understand? Come on, read.
Unto all the congregation.
Unto all the congregation. Who's the congregation? The congregation is the 12 tribes of Israel. That's who the congregation is. The congregation is the 12 tribes of Israel. Read that again.
The book of Joshua. Chapter 9, verse 21.
Read.
And the princes said unto them, let them live, but let them be hewers of wood and drawers of water.
Let them be hewers of wood and drawers of water unto what?
Unto all the congregation.
Read.
As the princes had promised them.
So now, remember, it says we're going to make them hewers of wood, we're going to make them drawers of water unto all the congregation. Meaning what? They are going to be servants. They are going to be slaves. Okay, go ahead. Verse 23 now. Jump down to verse 23.
23. Now therefore, ye are cursed, and there shall none of you be free from being bondmen.
You see that? From being what?
From being bondmen.
So if you are a drawer of water, you are a bondman. You are a slave. Read.
And hewers of wood.
And hewers of wood.
And drawers of water.
And drawers of water, come on.
For the house of my God.
You see that thing? That's what our forefathers was telling these Canaanites. So when it says in the lands of in the places of drawing water, meaning what? In the lands of our captivity, because we are slaves, we are bond men. You see that thing? We jump down to verse 27 now. Come on.
And Joshua made them that day hewers of wood and drawers of water.
And drawers of water.
For the congregation.
Read.
And for the altar of the Lord.
Read.
Even unto this day, in the place which he should choose.
In the place which he should choose. Give me that in 2 Chronicles. Okay? In the place, you know what? Let me not go there. Let me not go there. Let's get it. Let's get some history. Give me Joshua 9 verse 1. We're going to read through verse 6. I'm just going to read through this. The people that were made hewers of wood and drawers of water, bondmen, let's read about them. Joshua 9 verse 1. We're going to read through verse 6.
The book of Joshua, chapter 9, verse 1.
Read.
And it came to pass, when all the kings which were on this side Jordan, in the hills and in the valleys, and in all the coast of the great sea,
come on,
over against Lebanon,
read.
The Hittites, and the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, the Hivites,
read.
And the Jebusites,
come on,
heard thereof.
Because they heard of what we was doing. Because we started conquering, putting them in check. Read the, if you read the book of Joshua, we conquered Jericho. And then we started pursuing these kings, killing them, taking their lands, and subduing them. Read.
That they gathered themselves together.
So these Canaanites, these Hamites, they gathered themselves together, come on.
To fight with Joshua.
To do what?
To fight with Joshua.
No, against.
To fight with Joshua.
Because we put fear on them. With, not against, with. They wanted to join to us, to fight with us so that they can be under our protection. You see that thing? Read.
To fight with Joshua and Israel with one accord.
That's the key right there. With one accord. Come on.
And when the inhabitants of Gibeon heard what Joshua had done unto Jericho and to Ai.
You see that thing? So they remember the history. Unlike today when the black men don't want to read their history. Read.
They did work
willingly. Come on.
And went and made as if they had been ambassadors.
Come on.
And took old sacks upon their asses and wine bottles, old and rent and bound up.
So they made themselves as the people that were struggling, that were withered, you understand, that were impoverished, so that we can feel sorry for them. Read.
And old shoes and clouted upon their feet, and old garments upon them.
Come on.
And all the bread of their provision was dry and moldy.
You see that thing? Read.
And they went to Joshua unto the camp at Gilgal, and said unto him and to the men of Israel, we be come from a far country. Now therefore make ye a league with us.
Now jump down to verse 8. Listen to what Joshua says. Some heavy stuff right here. Beautiful history.
Verse 8. And they said unto Joshua, we are thy servants. And Joshua said unto them,
listen,
who are ye?
Who are you?
And from whence come ye?
You see what he's saying? Who are you? Where you come from? You just want to be a bond servant. Meaning what? What is your objective? Why would you willingly just give yourself to us? Why? What is the objective behind your actions? That is what Joshua was asking. Guess what? But Joshua made a league with them, and guess what? He couldn't break that league. Why? Because he made an oath. Because our forefathers, they were men of their word. They made an oath, they fulfilled it. That's why they could not kill them. Instead of killing them, we made them slaves and bondmen. That's why. Go back to Judges now. 5 verse 11.
The book of Judges, chapter 5, verse 11.
Read.
They that are delivered from the noise of archers in the place of drawing water.
Now we understand what that means now. Everybody get that now?
Yes, sir.
Read.
There shall they rehearse.
There, in the lands or in the places of drawing water, in the lands of our captivity, we shall what?
There shall they rehearse the righteous acts of the Lord.
We shall rehearse the righteous acts of the Lord. Remember what we read in the book of Baruch. Go back to Baruch chapter 2 verse 32. I know some of you forgot already. Baruch chapter 2 verse 32 again.
The book of Baruch chapter 2 verse 32.
Read.
And they shall praise me in the land of their captivity.
You see that thing? We're going to praise the Lord in the land of our captivity. How? We're going to rehearse the righteous acts. That's why today we are observing the Feast of Pentecost. Because that's how we're going to praise the Lord in the land of our slavery. Rehearsing the righteous acts. Okay, Titus 2 verse 11. Titus 2 verse 11.
The book of Titus, chapter 2 verse 11.
Read.
For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men.
Come on.
Teaching us that, denying ungodliness.
Grace is supposed to teach us to deny ungodliness, read.
And worldly lust.
Worldly lust, because what? Yes, that of the world is not of the Father. Read.
We should live soberly.
Righteously, keeping the commandments, come on.
And godly. In this present world.
In this present world. What are we reading? What we are reading right now is what we just read in Judges 5. In this present world, we must live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. We must rehearse the righteous acts in this present world. That's the precept for Judges 5 verse 11, by the way. You understand? Now watch this. Give me the book of Malachi 4 verse 4. We must live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Watch this. Malachi chapter 4 verse 4.
The book of Malachi, chapter 4, verse 4.
This is how we're going to praise the Lord in the land of our captivity. You understand? This is how we're going to praise the Most High God. Malachi 4, verse 4.
The book of Malachi, chapter 4, verse 4.
Read.
Remember ye the law of Moses by 7.
You see that thing? That's the first thing we're commanded to remember. The law. Because the law, that's how you know the Lord. And that's how you know the do's and don'ts of the Most High. Okay, come on.
Which I commanded unto him in Horeb.
Read.
For all Israel. With the statutes and judgments.
Come on.
Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord.
What you are seeing right now is what? The Lord is promising us, listen, I'm going to send you Elijah the prophet before the what? Read that part again.
Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord.
Before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord, he says, I'm promising you, my children, I'm going to send you hope. You understand? I'm going to cleanse you from your evils, and you will praise me in the land of your captivity. How will he do it? He will send us Elijah the prophet in the last days, before the second coming of the Messiah. Read.
And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children.
He shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children. Who's the fathers? Joshua, Jeremiah, Micah, Nahum, Nehemiah, Habakkuk. You understand? The Apostle Paul, Luke, Matthew, Mark, John. Those are our forefathers. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Okay, come on.
And the heart of the children to their fathers.
And the heart of the children back to their fathers. You understand? Because the heart of the children today, the heart of the children of Israel today is the heart of the other nations. Is the mind, is the programming of the other nations through media, television. You understand? All of these social media platforms they've got, that's the mind of the black man and the black woman and child today. So the Lord sent Elijah, said, listen, I need to cleanse you from your sins. How am I going to do it? I'm going to send you Elijah. We are walking in the footsteps of Elijah this day. Because the same thing that Elijah did, we are doing it this day. Read.
Lest I come and smite the earth with a curse.
Before I come and bring forth judgment on this earth. That's what he said. That's a promise. The fact that you are seeing us right now is because Elijah came and left. What did Elijah teach? Verse 4 again.
The book of Malachi, chapter 4, verse 4.
Read.
Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant.
That's what Elijah came and taught. The law. And that's what we are teaching this day. The law. Feast of Pentecost is a law for us to observe. Okay, watch this. John 14:26. He says, remember ye the law of Moses, my servant. We must remember the law. Okay? John 14:26.
The book of John, chapter 14, verse 26.
Read.
But the Comforter.
But the what?
But the Comforter.
But the Comforter. Go ahead.
Which is the Holy Ghost?
Which is the Holy Ghost, read.
Whom the Father will send in my name.
Whom the Father will send in my name. Come on.
He shall teach you all things.
He shall teach you all things, the Comforter, which the Lord will send in his name. Read.
And bring all things to your remembrance.
You see what the Comforter will do? The Comforter will teach us all things and bring all things to our remembrance. That's why it says, in the land of their captivity, they shall remember themselves. You shall bethink yourself. You will remember. Everything about yourself will be brought to your remembrance. Because how is it going to happen? The Lord will send Elijah the prophet in the last days. That's how these things will be brought to remembrance, because all the prophets walked in the Spirit of Christ. Okay? Read that again. Verse 26.
The book of John, chapter 14, verse 26.
Read.
But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost,
read.
Whom the Father will send in my name,
come on.
He shall teach you all things.
He will teach us all things, the sons and daughters, to turn the heart of the fathers to the children, to turn, and what? And to turn the heart of the children to back to their fathers. Read.
And bring all things to your remembrance,
and
whatsoever I have said unto you.
You see that thing? So that Comforter, who is the Comforter? Jump up to verse 18, let's find out who the Comforter is.
John chapter 14, verse 18.
Read.
I will not leave you comfortless.
This is Christ speaking now. I will not leave you comfortless. Read.
I will come to you.
You see that thing? Christ says, I will come to you. How is Christ going to come to us? The prophets will be moving in the Spirit of Christ. Okay, give me that in 1 Peter 1. Christ says, he will come to us. He will comfort us. Okay? No, 1 Peter 1. Yes, 1 Peter 1, verse 11.
1 Peter chapter 1, verse 11.
Come on.
Searching what? Or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, which was in them.
You see that thing? The Spirit of Christ which was in them. Who's the them? The prophets. Okay, Elijah was one of them. We are those prophets that today back on this earth. Read.
When he testified beforehand the suffering of Christ.
Beforehand, the suffering of Christ, because the prophets Moses, you understand, in the law, the prophets, you understand, in Nehemiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, so on and so forth, Isaiah, they prophesied beforehand the sufferings of the Lord. Right?
And the glory that should follow.
And the kingdom that will come upon this earth. This is the beginning of it. This is the kingdom of heaven that is being set up right now. This is not the kingdom of heaven, but this is steps to the kingdom. Understand it. Okay, watch this. Go back to where it was at. John 14.
John chapter 14, verse 18.
Uh-huh.
I will not leave you comfortless.
I will not leave you comfortless, my children. Read.
I will come to you.
I will come to you. When Christ came to us in the spirit, you understand, of the prophets, because the spirit of Christ was in the prophets. The spirit of Christ is in the prophets. If you have an ear, you'll hear what I'm saying. Jump down to verse 26.
Verse 26.
Come on.
But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name.
Whom the Father will send in my name.
He shall teach you all things.
He shall what?
He shall teach you all things.
He shall teach you all things. Come on.
And bring all things to your remembrance.
And bring all things to your remembrance.
Whatsoever I have said unto you.
So the things that are brought to our remembrance, one of those things is what? The high holidays, the feasts. You understand? Watch this. Give me Leviticus 23 verse 2 now. Leviticus 23. Watch this. No. Wait. John 5. John 5, 46. Remember he said, I'm going to send you Elijah the prophet to bring everything to your remembrance. You understand? To turn the heart of the fathers to the children and the heart of the children back to their fathers. To bring all things to our remembrance because we forgot all things. You understand? Then John chapter 5 verse 46.
The book of John chapter 5 verse 46.
Read.
For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me.
Uh-huh.
For he wrote of me.
So this is Christ speaking. He says, for if you believe Moses, you would have believed me because Moses wrote of me. Read.
But if ye believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words?
So now the words that Moses spoke unto us, the first five books, that was Christ. That was Christ right there. Read again verse 46.
The book of John, chapter 5, verse 46.
Come on.
For had ye believed Moses,
read.
Ye would have believed me.
Ye would have believed me. Come on.
For he wrote of me.
For he wrote of me. No, so let's think about that. Because what we're about to read, that's the spirit of Christ. Okay? Leviticus 23 verse 2.
The book of Leviticus, chapter 23 verse 2.
Uh-huh.
Speak unto the children of Israel.
This is the children of Israel right here. Go ahead.
And say unto them,
uh-huh,
concerning the feasts of the Lord.
Concerning the feasts of the Lord. Read out.
Which ye shall proclaim to be holy convocation.
Holy convocation, meaning gather yourself together. Read.
Even these are my feasts.
Even these are my feasts. Jump down to verse 4 now. Come on.
Verse 4. These are the feasts of the Lord. Even holy convocation.
Uh-huh.
Which ye shall proclaim in their seasons.
Which we shall proclaim in their seasons. You understand? In their seasons. Now we are in the season where we are supposed to observe the feast of Pentecost. That's the season. Okay? That's the season that we're in right now. Jump down to verse 15.
Verse 15.
Uh-huh.
And ye shall count unto you from the morrow after the Sabbath.
He says, ye shall count. You shall count unto you from the morrow after the Sabbath. This is after what? This is after Passover. When Passover is done, you will count what? Read that again, verse 15, so I can explain it.
Leviticus chapter 23, verse 15.
Read.
And ye shall count unto you from the morrow after the Sabbath,
uh-huh,
from the day that he brought the sheaf of the way offering.
Uh-huh.
7 Sabbaths shall be complete.
It says 7 Sabbaths shall be complete. Which means what? You have to count 7 complete days. That's the week. You understand? You get to, so 7 days must pass. Another 7 days until you get to the 7th Sabbath. How many days has passed? 49 days. That's what he's saying right there. You understand? Because we observe the Passover. You understand? So when the week begins, which is on Sunday, what we call it today, you will count until what? Saturday. That's the first week. Then you're going to count another. The second week. So on until the 7th week. That 7 Sabbaths shall be complete. Go ahead.
Even unto the morrow after the seventh Sabbath.
Even what?
Even unto the morrow after the seventh Sabbath.
He says, even unto the morrow after the seventh Sabbath. So the morrow after the seventh Sabbath is when? When does the day begin, brothers?
Sundown.
When?
Sundown.
When does the day begin?
Sundown, sir.
Sundown, okay?
Yes, sir.
The day begins at sundown. Read the part again.
Leviticus chapter 23, verse 16. Even unto the morrow after the seventh Sabbath shall he number 50 days.
Shall he what?
Shall he number 50 days.
So even unto the morrow after the Sabbath, after the seventh Sabbath, shall he number 50 days. So the 50 days, the morrow after the Sabbath, that's the key. Seventh Sabbath and the morrow after the Sabbath, you shall number 50 days. So 7 times 7, 49 plus 1 day, which is the morrow after the Sabbath, and what? Saturday, sundown. So the Feast of Pentecost will always fall on a so-called Sunday. All the time. Okay? Come on.
And ye shall offer a new meat offering unto the Lord.
You see that thing? Now, give me the Pentecost, okay? Page 446. Pentecost. Pentecost. What does Pentecost mean? Pentecost. Okay? Pentecost. Page 446. So what we're reading here is how to count and number the days to get to what? To get to the Feast of Pentecost. Because our forefathers and foremothers, they observed the Feast of Passover and they remained in Jerusalem until today so that they can observe the Feast of Pentecost. You understand? And guess what? They stayed again for the next feast that was coming, the memorial of blowing of trumpets. And the next feast that was coming, the Feast of Tabernacles, we set up booths, is still coming. You understand? So all of this is to the edifying of the body of Christ. Don't think that now that we're in captivity, because we're not under the law of sacrifice no more. But guess what? There's a spiritual understanding to this thing. Read that. Pentecost.
The definition of Pentecost.
I need some power in this thing. Come on.
The definition of Pentecost.
Read.
From the Sullivan Bible Dictionary.
Read.
Page 446.
Uh-huh.
Pentecost.
Mm-hmm.
The word derives from the Greek for the 50th day.
You see that thing? The word Pentecost is a word that was derived from the Greek tongue to mean what?
The 50th day.
The 50th day. Penta means 50. Penta means 5. Cost. Pentecost. 50th. Penta means 5. Pentecost is 50th. Read the part again.
The word derives from the Greek for the 50th day.
For the 50th day, read.
It was the Jewish Feast of Weeks.
Not Jewish, but the Jews. Because you know how Israel is with these historical records. Read.
Variously called the Feast of Harvest.
You see, the Feast of Harvest. Because that's why the Feast of First Fruits. Okay? Because guess what? During harvest season, the first of our fruits, that will belong to the Lord. We wouldn't eat anything until we sacrificed, until what? Until the priest will present a wave offering before the congregation, before the Lord. Then after that is done, then we eat what is left. Okay? Is that it on that? That's it on that. Let's leave it there. Go back to Leviticus. Okay, Leviticus 23 verse 16 again.
The book of Leviticus chapter 23 verse 16.
Read.
Even unto the morrow after the seventh Sabbath shall ye number 50 days, and ye shall offer a new meat offering unto the Lord.
Ye shall offer a new meat offering unto the Lord. Come on, verse 17.
Ye shall bring out of your habitations two wave loaves of two ten deals. They shall be of fine flour, they shall be baked with leaven.
Read.
They are the first fruits unto the Lord.
They are the first fruits unto the Lord. They are the first fruits unto the Lord. Because today we don't own nothing. We don't own land. We don't own sheep, nothing. And most importantly above all, we are not under the law of animal sacrifice. Watch this. Give me Numbers 28, verse 26. Numbers 28, verse 26.
The book of Numbers, chapter 28, verse 26.
Read.
also in the day of the first fruits.
That's where we have now. The day of the first fruits. Go ahead.
When ye bring a new meat offering unto the Lord.
A new meat offering. You to know the details about the meat offering, you must read Leviticus the second chapter. Read. After your weeks be out. Meaning what? Those seventh Sabbath, when the beginning of the Feast of Pentecost, that's what it's talking about. After your weeks be out, meaning what? At the time of your harvest. Read.
Ye shall have an holy convocation.
Ye shall what?
Ye shall have an holy convocation.
We must gather ourselves together. Come on.
Ye shall do no several work.
You shall do no several work because it's a Sabbath day. It's a Sabbath day. We must come together and observe it because it is a Sabbath. It's a Sabbath day. Watch this. Give me the book of Deuteronomy 16 verse 9. Deuteronomy chapter 16 verse 9.
The book of Deuteronomy chapter 16 verse 9.
Read.
7 weeks shall thou number unto thee.
7 weeks shall we number plus one day, the morrow after the seventh Sabbath. Read.
Begin to number the 7 weeks from such time as thou beginnest to put the sickle to the corn.
The sickle to the corn, what is that talking about? Because at the time of harvest, those that were harvesting wheat, you understand, and corn, what would happen? They will take this, it's a string, they tie it around the corn that they've harvested. That's the sickle to the corn. To tie it up, you see in the field, you understand? Omashimu, let me put it like that. You understand? So when they're harvesting, they'll be picking out the corn and tying it in different places in the field. As preparation for what? Because it's harvest season. Okay? Read.
And thou shalt keep the Feast of Weeks unto the Lord thy God.
You shall what?
Thou shalt keep the Feast of Weeks unto the Lord thy God.
Read.
With the tribute of a freewill offering of thine hand.
Come on.
Which thou shalt give unto the Lord thy God, according as the Lord thy God has blessed thee.
You're going to give according to as the Lord has blessed you. You understand? We did it back then, so it is today. You have more, give more. Why? Because that's how we did it back then. Don't be cheap. That's what the Lord is saying. Read.
And thou shalt rejoice before the Lord thy God.
We shall what?
Thou shalt rejoice before the Lord thy God.
That's why I don't want to see anybody in the spirit of what? I don't want to see that spirit of a demon up in here. If I see it, I will check you. Okay? Because I've already seen it already. You can't make this stuff up. I've seen this that spirit already. You can't make this stuff up. You can't. I can't believe this. And you wonder why there's no change in your life. Read that part again.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 16, verse 10.
Verse 11.
Verse 11.
Read.
And thou shalt rejoice before the Lord thy God.
Come on.
Thou and thy son.
You see that thing? We and our sons. Go ahead.
And thy daughter.
And our daughters. Read on.
And thy manservant.
And our manservant.
And thy maidservant.
We don't have that. Read.
And the Levite that is within thy gates.
Come on.
And the stranger. And the fatherless.
Read.
And the widow that are among you in the place which the Lord thy God had chosen to place his name there.
Now give me 2 Chronicles now, 6 verse 6. Okay? I was really just getting ahead of myself. 2 Chronicles 6 verse 6, it says, in the name which the Lord hath chosen to place his name there. Because we did this in Jerusalem. We're not in Jerusalem no more, but we are Jerusalem. Okay? Read what you call 2 Chronicles 6 verse 6.
2 book of Chronicles chapter 6 verse 6.
Read.
But I have chosen Jerusalem.
But I have done what?
I have chosen Jerusalem.
But I have chosen Jerusalem, come on.
That my name might be there.
That my name might be there. Read.
And have chosen David to be over my people Israel.
That my name might be there. We just heard what the name of the Lord is. We are not in our land. But where the land of our captivity, he says, guess what? We're going to what? We're going to name the name of the Lord. When what? In the land of our captivity, we're going to praise him and name the name of the Lord. He says, I've chosen Jerusalem that my name might be there. What is the name of the Lord? His commandments. So the name of the Lord is upon us when we keep his laws. When we was in the Christian church, the name of the Lord was not upon us. Certainly not a sister wearing pants like we saw a cat. The hell is this? talking about the name of the Lord. Watch this. Give me Exodus 34, 22. Exodus chapter 34, verse 22.
The book of Exodus, chapter 34, verse 22.
Come on.
And thou shalt observe the feast of weeks.
You shall observe the feast of weeks. That's where we at now. Read.
Of the first fruits of wheat harvest.
Of the first fruits of wheat harvest. Read.
And the feast of ingathering at the year's end.
The feast of ingathering is the feast of tabernacles. We're not there yet. Okay? But I want to show you that we must observe the Feast of Weeks. It's also called the Feast of Weeks. The Feast of First Fruits is also called the Feast of Weeks. So when you see the Feast of Weeks, you must know it's talking about the Feast of First Fruits. Okay? Watch this. Give me the book of Tobit. Remember, it says we must observe the righteous acts of the Lord. We must rehearse in this present world. In the land of captivity, we must praise the Lord. How do we do that? We rehearse the righteous acts. Today we are rehearsing one of those righteous acts. Okay? Read what you got? Tobit 2, verse 1.
The book of Tobit, chapter 2, verse 1.
Okay, this is during the time when we was under the Assyrian Empire. Read what you got?
Now when I was come home again, and my wife Anna was restored unto me,
read,
with my son Tobias, in the feast of Pentecost.
You see that thing? The feast of weeks, the feast of what? First fruits is also called the feast of Pentecost. Read.
Which is the holy feast of the 7 weeks.
You see that thing? Which is the holy feast of the 7 weeks. Read.
There was a good dinner prepared me.
And there was a what?
A good dinner prepared me.
That's what I'm looking at right now at the back. A good dinner was prepared for us. Read.
In the which I sat down to eat.
You see that thing? So I don't want to see nobody sitting around moping, feeling like a small puppy. Okay? Read that again.
The book of Tobit, chapter 2, verse 1.
Read.
Now when I was come home again, and my wife Anna was restored unto me, with my son Tobias, in the feast of Pentecost, which is the holy feast of the 7 weeks.
Read.
There was a good dinner.
There was a good dinner. There was no death in the pot. That's why he's making reference. Says there was a good dinner, no death in the pot. Okay, read on.
In the which I sat down to eat.
Because if it's a good dinner, you'll be able to sit down and eat. But if there's death in the pot, nobody sits down to eat. Nobody will sit down to eat if there's death in the pot. Watch this. Give me the book of 2 Maccabees 12:31. Now, this is what we was in the Assyrian Empire under Shalmaneser, okay? In Tobit, they call him Enemesar, which is what? In Greek. Okay? Give me that in 2 Maccabees 12, verse 31.
2 book of Maccabees, chapter 12, verse 31.
Read.
They gave them thanks, desiring them to be friendly still unto them.
Read.
And so they came to Jerusalem.
They did what?
They came to Jerusalem.
They came to Jerusalem. Right? For now we cannot go to Jerusalem. We are not in our land, but we must still observe the righteous acts. What I want to show you is that we still must keep these laws. We must still observe these high holidays in the land of our captivities because our forefathers did. Read.
The feast of the weeks approaching.
The feast of weeks approaching. Next verse. Go ahead.
And after the feast, called Pentecost.
Called what?
Called Pentecost.
You see, the Feast of Weeks is called Pentecost, the 50th day. Read.
They went forth against Gogias, the governor of Idumea.
After we observed the feast, we went to war. That's beautiful right there. Okay. After the feast, we went to war to conquer Idumea, Edom. Beautiful stuff right here. Okay, watch this. Give me the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 1. Now, this is Greece, what we just read. Now we're going to Rome now. Acts 2, verse 1.
The book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 1.
Read.
And when the day of Pentecost was fully come.
When the day, did you say a religion called Pentecost?
When the day of Pentecost,
read.
Was fully come,
which is where we are now. Read.
They were all with one accord in one place.
I need you to read that last part of that reason, because this right here is the reason why sometimes really I will blow up here. This part right here, listen, this is kryptonite to the black man and the black woman. Especially the black woman. Let me say that again in case I started. No, I didn't start up. Especially the black woman. Read again.
They were all with one accord in one place.
In one accord, in one place. One accord, one place. What is this teaching us? Unity. One mind, one spirit, one judgment. You get a command executed. I don't want to see nobody twitching like a robot up in here. I don't want to see that thing. Why? We are at war. We must gather together. How is it that the nations don't know this Bible, but they know how to gather together? What is wrong with the black man and the black woman? The nations don't have this book. You have the greatest knowledge on earth, but you are still niggering up in here. Read the thing again. Come on.
Chapter 2, verse 1.
Read.
And when the day of Pentecost was fully come,
read,
they were all with one accord in one place.
One accord in one place. What is the Apostle Luke teaching us here? Unity. Our forefathers and foremothers were in one accord, everyone in their proper order. Nobody moving like a rat, nobody moving like a cat. No, no. Everybody was soldiering on in proper order. Sisters need knew how to deal with one another, because the sisters do not know how to apply the civil laws. Let me say that again. You sisters don't know how to apply the civil law. You don't know how to do it. And the same thing that I'm seeing in the world, I'm seeing it in Israel. You can make this stuff up. In Israel, I'm seeing the same garbage. Why? Because you're not in the Bible. You don't study. You don't apply. Them days are over. You will be checked. I'm going to look at you like with a microscope. I'm telling you. Nobody's going to mess up what we are building here. Because the Negroes were built innately to destroy from within. That's the default setting of the Negro. The default setting of the Negro is to destroy from within. When you come in Israel, you want to do the same thing. Because the spirit of the Negro is irritated by progress. When men and women are making progress, the Negro will always be irritated by progress. Them days are over. Understand it. We are not going to tolerate that BS up in here. You brothers understand it?
Yes, sir.
Read that again, verse 1.
Acts chapter 2, verse 1.
This is not a laughing matter at all. Okay? Because the stuff that we see out there on the streets when we go to teach, we should not be finding the same garbage in here. When our people come in here, they must see men and women in order. And I'm going to stress it. Women in order, men in order. And the black woman will fall in line. Because that's what I've seen. I'm seeing it. It's like every year we have to, man, you can't make this stuff up. You just can't. You cannot make it up. You know, we have to deal with brothers with yellow sneakers like this Xavier that I'm seeing here. Yesterday we were dealing with a brother with a yellow sneaker and a pink t-shirt. Guess what? In Israel, the same spirit, not that they're wearing fringes, but this is how they look on the spin in the inside. Outside they look good, but inside they look like this. Read verse 1 again. Let me calm down.
Okay. The book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 1.
Come on.
And when the day of Pentecost was fully come,
wait.
They were all with one accord in one place.
You see that thing? That's a law. This is not a suggestion. The Bible is not a book of Barney. It's not a book of Teletubbies. No, no. The Bible is a book of law and order. And that's kryptonite to the black man and the black woman. Oh, yes. Because this is a laughing matter, by the way. You see, one thing I've seen, let me tell you what happens in Israel. Sisters don't take this seriously. Oh yes, yeah. Understand that. I'm watching you. I'm watching all of you. Very particular. Some things I will wink at them. Some things I won't. Because there's a lot of things that I see, and I'm not going to address them. Why? Because you know what? I'll wink at that ignorance. But there are some things I won't wink at them. Why? Because I understand the impact it will have if it's not checked. And I need you men to man up. I need you men to stone up. I don't want no man is going to be run by a woman up in here. You better fall in line, fall in your proper order. You sisters too. Yes. You sisters, you better fall in your proper order. The Most High God has given you clear instruction. All the classes that came out is for you to fall in line. But a lot of you, you don't want to do it because you are rebellious. You hate what is written. And I'm seeing that spirit. That thing is vexing my spirit. Why? Because you are going against progress. That will not happen up in here. Okay? And the prayer is this. This is the prayer. That the Lord will send able, reliable, dependable sisters in here, and men too. So those that will help us build. Okay? The black leadership demons, you can drop dead. I'm changing straight. Yeah? You, if you are a black ashy demon, you can drop dead. Because right now we are at a critical time in this camp where the Lord is really doing glorious things happening in Israel. That's one thing I can tell you. There's glorious things happening in Israel. Nobody's going to stop this. This chain is going to move. And it's going to move so fast, either you're going to be on board or you're going to drop off. That's what's coming. Watch this. Let's move on now. Give me the book of Deuteronomy. No. Give me the book of Acts, chapter 20. Acts 20, verse 16. Because we are in Rome, let me calm down. Acts 20, verse 16. Okay, there were our forefathers and foremothers, they came together from different lands to come and observe the Feast of Pentecost. Now watch this. Now remember, this is after Christ died, resurrected the third day, and left. Right? So Christ is gone at this point. This is the Acts of the Apostles. Right? This is the Acts of the Apostles, right?
Yes,
brothers?
Yes, sir.
So that means Christ is gone, right?
Always.
So now, are our forefathers observing the feast yet? Are they doing it?
Yes, sir.
Good. I'm glad you can see that. Because Christ is gone, we are still supposed to observe these laws. Acts 20, verse 16.
The book of Acts, chapter 20, verse 16.
Read.
For Paul had determined to sail by Ephesus.
Ephesus. Okay, come on.
Because he would not spend the time in Asia.
Meaning Asia Minor. Read.
For he hasted.
He hasted.
If it were possible for him.
Read.
To be at Jerusalem the day of Pentecost.
You see that thing? He observed the Feast of Pentecost. The Apostle Paul. He observed the Feast of Pentecost. That is what we observe in this day, in the spirit of our Lord and Savior, the Christ. You should have great joy, brothers and sisters.
All praises.
Okay? You should rejoice in the Lord. Watch this. Now, Romans 7, verse 14. Let me switch gears a little bit. Because now we understand that our forefathers observed the Feast of Pentecost. They were offering their offerings of the first fruits of the corn and wheat harvest. Okay, and they offered up sacrifices of meat offerings. You understand? Give me that. Leviticus 23, real quick. Let me just touch on that real quick. Leviticus 23. Go back there. 1 second. Leviticus 23 and verse 10.
The book of Leviticus, chapter 23, verse 10.
Read.
Speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, when ye be come into the land which I give unto you,
that's the land of Israel,
and shall reap the harvest thereof,
and you shall what?
Reap the harvest
thereof. You shall reap the harvest thereof, come on.
Then ye shall bring a sheaf of the first fruits.
The sheaf of the first fruits, that's what your wheat, during your wheat harvest, your wheat and corn harvest, you bring a sheaf. You tie it with a sickle, you present before the Lord. Read.
The sheaf of the first fruits of your harvest unto the priest.
Come on.
And he shall wave.
And the priest, he is the priest that shall what?
And he shall wave the sheaf before the Lord.
The priest, the Levites, they will wave the sheaf before the Lord. Come on.
To be accepted for you.
To be accepted for you, wait.
On the morrow after the Sabbath.
And
the priest shall wave.
You see that thing? On the morrow after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. Now, watch this. We are no longer under the law of animal sacrifice, but we are still supposed to observe the feast. Watch this. Give me the book of Romans 7 verse 14. I'm almost done. Romans 7 verse 14.
The book of Romans chapter 7 verse 14.
I need you to pay close attention here. Come on.
For we know that the law is spiritual.
For we know. Meaning this was a known thing in Israel. There was no confusion. Our forefathers was aware. That is what? Read that again.
For we know that the law is spiritual.
We know it. We know that the law is spiritual. Everything that you do, what that the law says, there's a spiritual thing that happens behind that. Okay? We know it. Our forefathers knew it, we know it as well. Watch this. Romans 5 verse 11. Because remember, we had to offer up sacrifices, right? The meat offerings. Watch this. Romans 5 verse 11.
The book of Romans chapter 5 verse 11.
So all the offerings that we did back then, this is what Christ did to those offerings. Watch this. Romans 5 verse 11.
The book of Romans chapter 5 verse 11.
Read.
And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Read.
By whom we have now received the atonement.
By whom, Christ, we have now received the atonement. What is that? The sacrifice. We have now received the sacrifice. Because Christ sacrificed himself for the 12 tribes. That's how we received the atonement of our sins. It's not talking about the day of atonement here. It's talking about atonement for our sins. Okay? Watch this. Hebrews 10 verse 1. You know what? Start at verse 8. Hebrews 10 verse 8 through 10. Hebrews 10 verse 8. We have now received the atonement.
The book of Hebrews chapter 10 verse 8. Above when he said, sacrifice an offering and burnt offerings. And offerings for sin that wouldest not.
You see that thing? Burnt offerings for sin that wouldest not. Sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings. Read.
Neither has pleasure therein.
The Lord does not have pleasure in that anymore. Come on.
Which are offered by the law.
Which are offered by the law. Which law? This law. The law of animal sacrifice. Sacrifice and offerings and burnt offerings. That's the law being referenced here. Read.
Then said he.
Then said he, go ahead.
No. I come to do thy will, O God.
Read.
He taketh away the first.
He taketh away the first covenant. Read.
That he may establish the second.
That he may establish the second covenant under Christ. Read.
By the which will we.
By the which will, come on.
By the which will we are sanctified.
We are what?
We are sanctified.
We are sanctified, go ahead.
Through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all.
You see that thing? Go back to Romans 5 verse 11 now. The Apostle Paul is explaining the same thing in different ways. Okay? Romans 5 verse 11.
The book of Romans chapter 5 verse 11.
Read.
And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Come on.
By whom we have now received the atonement.
By whom we have now received the sacrifice. That's what we just read in the book of Hebrews. The law of animal sacrifice was done. Now we are under Christ now. You understand? We keep the laws in the faith of Christ. Watch this. Give me 1 Corinthians 15 verse what? Verse 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 19. Remember, it says we know that the law is spiritual. Now we're going to get you to the spiritual understanding of what the Feast of First Fruits is about. Okay? 1 Corinthians 15. Verse 19.
1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19.
Come on. No, no. Wait. 1 Corinthians 15. Give me one second. No, no. I don't want verse 15. Verse 9. No, start at verse 5. Start at verse 5. Read that. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 5.
1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 5.
Read.
And that he was seen of Cephas.
He was what?
He was seen of Cephas.
He was seen of Cephas. That's Peter. Come on.
Then of the 12.
Then of the 12, meaning what? The 12 disciples. Read.
After that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once.
He was seen of a what?
He was seen of above, you know, 500.
I'm sorry. Start at verse 3.
Sir, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. How that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures.
So Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures.
And that he was buried.
He was what?
That he was buried. And that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures.
He rose again the third day according to the scriptures. Read on.
And that he was seen of Cephas.
Read verse 4 again. Read verse 3 and 4 together.
1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures.
Oh yeah, now I understand. You know what, Mdlandla? Just hold what you got. We're gonna come back here. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 19. Yeah, I was correct. What am I doing?
Okay. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19.
My bad. Come on, read that.
If in this life only we have hope in Christ.
He says, if in this life only we have hope in Christ. Read.
We are of all men most miserable.
He says, we are of all men most miserable. Watch this, come on.
But now is Christ risen from the dead.
Read.
And become the first fruits.
And become what?
And become the first fruits.
So Christ was risen from the dead. He became the what?
And become the first fruits.
He became the first fruits, read on.
Of them that slept.
So Christ became the first fruit of them that slept. Who the them that slept? That's us. Spiritually dead. So Christ became that first fruit of them that slept. Next verse. Watch this.
For since
this is beautiful history right here. Pay attention. Read.
Verse 21. For since by man came death.
Come on.
By man came also the resurrection of the dead.
Because the resurrection of the dead came through Christ to revive those that have slept. Read.
For
as in Adam, the first man, our forefather Adam, read.
Even so in Christ shall all be made alive.
You see that thing? In Christ shall all 12 tribes be made alive. In Christ, the 12 tribes will be resurrected. But Christ is the first fruits unto them that have slept, that's us. So Christ came to resurrect the 12 tribes of Israel. So his death and resurrection was symbolic of the children of Israel being brought together so we can think and move and talk as one. To resurrect us from the dead, to teach us unity, to bring all 12 together because there was a split in the nation. So Christ's blood is the only way the 12 tribes was to be brought together. That is what we're reading here. Read verse 20 again.
1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 20.
Read.
But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept.
Now jump down to verse 23, come on.
23. But every man in his own order.
Stop right there. What?
But every man in his own order.
The Bible is a book of order. Read.
Christ, the first fruits.
You see that thing? Christ, the first fruits. Christ is the first fruit. So if you're not in order, Christ, you're not going to see Christ as the first fruit. And how are you going to be that fruit? If you're not in order, that's not going to happen. Read.
Afterward, they that are Christ's at his coming.
They that are Christ's, those that belong to Christ at his coming, is those that are going to be in order and they're going to follow after the footsteps of Christ and become the first fruit as well, just like Christ did. Watch this. Give me the book of Revelation 1 and 5. It says, Christ, the first fruits. Okay? Revelation 1, verse 5.
The book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 5.
Read.
And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead.
The first begotten of the dead. The first fruit. The first fruit. The first begotten. He's the first fruit of the day. Who's the dead? Us. Them that slept in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20. Read.
And the prince of the kings of the earth.
The prince of the kings of the earth. We're the kings of the earth. Read.
and to him that loved us.
You see that he loved us. How did he do it? He sent his son Christ to die for our sins. Right?
And washed us from our sins in his own blood.
Uh-huh.
And has made us kings and priests unto God.
Now that's something else. Okay. Go give me Colossians 1:15. Remember, Christ is the first fruits. Christ is the first fruit, the first begotten of the dead. Who's the dead? The dead is us without these laws. Okay? Colossians 1:5. No, 1:15.
The book of Colossians, chapter 1:15.
Come on.
Who is the image of the invisible God?
Who is the image of the invisible God? Come on.
The firstborn.
The what?
Every creature. The firstborn.
The firstborn. The firstborn. The first begotten. The first fruit. Read.
The firstborn of every creature.
Uh-huh. The firstborn of every creature. Jump down to verse 18.
Verse 18.
Uh-huh.
And he is the head of the body.
He is the head of the body. Who? The body is the 12 tribes of Israel. The body is the nation. Read.
The church.
The church. Come on.
Who is the beginning?
Who is the beginning?
And who is the beginning?
Come on.
The firstborn from the dead.
The firstborn from the dead. After how many days did he rise? The third day. Okay? The firstborn, the first fruit, the first begotten. You understand? Read.
That in all things
uh-huh.
he might have the preeminence.
He might have the preeminence because the man rose from the dead. Okay? Watch this. Go back to 1 Corinthians now, 15. Read verse 20 and 23.
First book of Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 20.
Watch this.
But now is Christ risen from the dead.
But now is Christ risen from the dead. Read on.
And become the first fruits of them that slept.
And become the first fruits of them that slept. Okay, read, jump down to verse 23. So Christ is that first fruit. Represents what? The Feast of Pentecost. Christ is that first fruit that represents the Feast of Pentecost. The first fruit, the first begotten of the dead. Okay, come on.
1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 23.
Read.
But every man in his own order.
Read on.
Christ is the first fruit.
Christ the first fruit, the firstborn, the first begotten. Read.
Afterward, they that are Christ's at his coming.
They that are what?
They that are Christ's at his coming.
Now watch this. This is what Christ said. Give me Matthew 12:39. Matthew 12:39 now. Watch this. Remember, Christ is the first fruit. We are observing the feast of the first fruits because Christ represents that. That verse says, I come in the volume of the book. When we were observing the feast of Pentecost in the wilderness, you understand? We were still under the law of animal sacrifice. That was symbolic of Christ. It represented Christ. You understand? That's why when Christ was teaching the disciples, where did he begin? He began at Moses. So when he was walking with them after he resurrected, he began at Moses and the prophets. So it says, then they knew who he was when he was done, explaining everything. That's when they figure out, oh, that's Christ right there. What did he do? He was explaining the Bible from Genesis. The whole day, he was explaining Genesis. Let's get it. Luke 23. I know some of you are looking at me with side eyes. Let's read it. Okay? Luke 23, come on, come on. Luke 24, verse 25. This is after he had resurrected, and they could not recognize him. Read what you got. So that's why I tell you, brothers and sisters, study. Because if you don't study from Genesis to Revelation, you're not going to understand Christ. You're not going to understand anything. You're not going to understand the Messiah. Okay? Read it.
The book of Luke, chapter 24, verse 25.
Come on.
Then he said unto them,
O fools,
and slow of heart.
Meaning what? He's slow of heart, because we're slow babies. We're dumb. We're slow. Read.
And slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
He says, you don't believe all that the prophets have spoken. Next verse. Watch this.
Ought not Christ to have suffered these things?
Now Christ is speaking. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things? Read.
And to enter into his glory.
And to enter into his glory. Read.
And beginning at Moses.
Where did he begin? He began at Moses, the law. Read.
And all the prophets.
He went through all the prophets. You brothers getting that? And you two men to understand what's coming out here.
All praise.
You understand that? Yes. It says, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets. Read.
He expounded unto them in all the scriptures.
In all the scriptures, beginning at Moses and all the prophets. Read.
The things concerning himself.
The things concerning himself. Watch this, go ahead.
And they drew nigh unto the village whither they went.
Read.
And he made as though he would have gone further.
Meaning what? He wanted to pass. He wanted to go somewhere else. Read.
But they constrained him.
They constrained him. Saying, what did they say?
Saying, abide with us.
Abide with us. Read.
For it is toward evening.
Hold on. It was what?
For it is toward evening.
It is toward evening. Watch this. Jump up to verse 21.
21. But we trusted.
No. Wait. Read 24 verse 1.
The book of Luke, chapter 24, verse 1.
Come on.
Now, upon the first day of the week.
What is the first day of the week? So-called Sunday. Read.
Very early in the morning.
Stop right there. What time was it?
Very early in the morning.
Very early in the morning. Now, let's go to where he was at now. Read verse 28 again. Remember the time.
24.
Hold on. Remember the time. It says very early in the morning. Right? Go ahead. Verse 28.
Luke chapter 24, verse 28.
Come on.
And they drew nigh unto the village.
They drew nigh unto the village. Come on.
Whither they went.
Whither they went.
And he made as though he would have gone further.
Uh-huh.
But they constrained him, saying, abide with us.
Uh-huh.
For it is toward evening.
Stop right there. So, they started very early in the morning. Now is the end of the day now. Towards the evening. So what was they doing? I need you men to think. When we go to camp and teach from sun up to sun down, what spirit are we moving in?
The
spirit of Christ.
That's right.
I need you men to understand where we are. Don't sleep on this Bible. Read that thing again.
Luke chapter 24. Verse 29.
Come on.
But they constrained him, saying, abide with us.
Read.
For it is toward evening, and the day is far spent.
The day is far spent. Read.
And he went in to tarry with them.
So he went in to tarry with them. The whole day has gone by. What was he doing? Jump up to verse 27.
27.
And
beginning at Moses and all the prophets.
He began at Moses very early in the morning. He began with Moses. Read.
He expounded unto
them. No. Start. Read the verse again. Beginning at Moses.
Beginning at Moses. And all the prophets.
And all the prophets. From sun up to sun down. That's some heavy stuff right there. If you leave this truth, shame on you. Read.
He expounded unto them in all the scriptures.
All the scriptures. Read on.
The things concerning himself.
The things concerning himself. I want you to see something. Read verse 30.
Verse 30. And it came to pass.
Read.
As he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and broke and
gave. He broke it and gave to them. He was breaking bread. He was expounding unto them the scriptures from sun up to sun down. After the whole day was done, he said, guess what? Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of the Lord. So the whole day, what was they doing? Precept upon precept, the whole day. That's some heavy stuff right there. You see what I mean? Listen, if you leave this truth, there's nothing I can do for you. Okay? Next verse. Verse 31. Watch this. Now, what I want to show you is this. Stop. Hold this. Give me Acts 17 verse 2. Let me show you something. Acts 17 verse 2. How long have we been in Santander? How many Sabbath days? 3 Sabbath days, right?
Yes, sir.
Read verse 2. Watch this. Pay attention.
The book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 2.
Come on.
And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them.
Come on.
And 3 Sabbath days.
How many Sabbath days?
3 Sabbath days.
3 Sabbath days. Go ahead.
Reasoned with them out of the scriptures.
He did what?
Reasoned with them out of the scriptures.
Reasoned with them out of the scriptures. Read on.
Opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered.
Read.
And risen again from the dead.
Uh-huh.
And that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ.
You see that thing? Next verse. Watch this.
And some of them believe.
Some of them believe. That's what we see when we were at camp. Okay, come on.
And consulted with Paul and Silas.
Meaning what? They agreed with what Paul and Silas were bringing out. Read.
And of the devout Greeks, a great multitude.
That's our forefathers that were scattered in the Greek, in the times of the Greeks. Read.
And of the chief women, not a few.
Whoa. Read the part again.
And of the chief women, not a few.
Because guess what? The Apostle Paul had disciples. And one among those disciples, the women was one among them. Yes, women are disciples. There's women disciples in the Bible. They were at Christ's feet. What was they doing? Learning. If you read Luke 10 verse 40, it tells you that. Okay. Read that again.
The book of Acts chapter 17 verse 4.
Read.
And some of them believed and consulted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude. And of the chief women, not a few.
Now watch this. The Apostle Paul, he reasoned with them out of the scriptures. So when we read precept upon precept, there are those that are going to believe, there are those that will not. Okay? Because we reason with them out of the scriptures. That's what I tell you, brothers. Stay in the Bible. This is your safety net. Okay? Watch this now. Acts 28. Okay? Acts 28 and verse 22. Watch this. No, start verse 23.
The book of Acts, chapter 28, verse 23.
Read.
And when they appointed him a day.
Now, this, the Apostle Paul was in Rome. That's why after the book of Acts, you see Rome. Okay? Why? Because he was under house arrest in Rome. That's why he wrote letters to the Romans. Our forefathers scattered in Rome because the Apostle Paul was under house arrest at this point. Read.
There came many to him into his lodging, to whom he expounded.
He did what?
To whom he expounded.
The people that came to learn when the Apostle Paul was under house arrest, to whom the people came to visit him, he expounded. Read on.
And testified the kingdom of God.
He did what?
And testified the kingdom of God.
He testified the kingdom of God. What are we doing when we're in camp? What are we doing up in here? Testifying the kingdom of God. Read.
Persuading them.
And what are we doing? Read.
Concerning Jesus.
Concerning Christ. Read.
Both out of the law of Moses.
Hold on. Both out of what?
Both out of the law of Moses.
That's the same thing that Christ did. Both out of the law of Moses. Read.
And out of the prophets.
Out of the prophets. Let me now read the next part of that verse.
From morning till evening.
That's amazing stuff right there. That's beautiful right there. Read it again.
From morning.
No, read it. But come on, don't mess me up, bro.
The book of Acts, chapter 28, verse 23.
Read.
And when they appointed him a day, there came men to him into his lodging, to whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of God.
Read.
Persuading them concerning Jesus, both out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets.
Stop right there. Now I want to show you something heavy about this verse. It says he expounded and testified the kingdom of God, right? Persuading them concerning Jesus. We understand that so far. How did he persuade them concerning Christ and concerning the kingdom of God? Out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets. So in order for you to teach the people Christ, you must teach the law. Where? Out of the law and out of the prophets. You will not be able to understand Christ if you come in some other way. That's why he was saying the thieves, they will come some other way. But those that are approved, they will use the door. This is the door right here. That's some heavy stuff right there. Keep reading. From what time?
From morning till evening.
From morning till evening. That's the same thing that Christ did. The Apostle Paul was just following after the footsteps. That's the same thing we have been today. Okay? Now go back to where he was at now. Luke 24, verse 31 now.
The book of Luke, chapter 24, verse 31.
Remember, now Christ is expounding unto them from morning to evening, beginning with Moses and the prophets, right? Concerning himself. So now you need to think about it and say, wait a minute. He's concerning the disciples, concerning himself from what? Genesis up to the prophets? Concerning himself, that means from the law, the prophets, concerns Christ. He is the subject. The law and the prophets, he is the subject matter. Read.
The book of Luke, chapter 24, verse 81.
Come on.
And their eyes were opened.
Stop right there. The people's eyes will not be open if you don't read the law and the prophets. If you just say in the letters of Paul, the people's eyes will not all be opened. Because the New Testament is abbreviated. You need some details. You must go to the law and the prophets. Because the prophets were confirming what? The law. What was Christ confirming? The law and the prophets concerning himself. Read.
And their eyes were opened.
Their eyes were opened.
And they knew him.
Stop right there. That's some heavy stuff right there. He says their eyes were opened and they what?
And they knew him.
They knew him. How did they know him? Because go back up. Read verse 27 again. That's a beautiful stuff right there.
27.
Uh-huh.
And beginning with Moses.
He began with Moses.
And all the prophets.
And all the prophets. Read.
He expounded unto them in all the scriptures.
In all the scriptures out of the law of Moses and the prophets.
The things concerning
himself. The things concerning himself. 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 Now read verse 31.
31.
Uh-huh.
And their eyes were open.
Their eyes were open concerning Christ. Read.
And they knew him.
And they knew him. The only way you're going to know Christ, he says, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me. Read.
And he vanished out of their sight.
You see that thing? But what I want to show you here is this. He expounded. The only way they could know him, he had to expound unto them out of the law and the prophets. That's when their eyes were open and they knew him. When you came into this truth, you didn't read the letters of Paul. You read Deuteronomy 28. You were like, wait a minute. That's me right there. Okay, now when you come into the New Testament, you're like, wait a minute. Luke 21 verse 20, Christ says, you will go into slavery. Hold on a second. You see the thing? That's how you know Christ. You're not going to know him without the law and the prophets. So our people in the Christian church, they don't know the law. They don't know Christ. That's right. They don't know him. You must consider yourself blessed to be up in here.
All
praise to the Most High. Let's give the Most High a hand for that thing. All praises to the Holy One of Israel. Okay? Now, give me, sidetrack, you know, give me Matthew 12, verse 39. Matthew 12, verse 39. Our Lord and Savior, the Master Teacher. Watch this. Matthew 12, verse 39. Yes. Remember, Christ said he will rise from the dead the third day, right? Okay, he's the first fruit of the dead, the first fruits of the begotten. Yes? Okay, come on.
Matthew chapter 12, verse 89.
Come on.
But he answered and said unto them,
and
an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after his sign.
They seek after a sign, read.
And there shall no sign be given to it.
No sign will be given to this evil and adulterous generation.
But the sign of the prophet Jonas.
The sign of the prophet Jonas, read.
For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights, in the whale's belly.
As Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, go ahead.
So shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth.
So now Christ is giving you the clues. He says, listen, the same way Jonah, why is Christ telling you? Read the book of Jonah. That's what he's saying right there. How are you going to know about what Jonah said if you don't read the book of Jonah? You see, Christ kept giving clues, but our people were just blind. They didn't understand what was going on. They said, well, we don't know what Christ is talking about. When Moses came back, we don't know what has become of him. Because what was Moses? What did he learn? He learned about Christ. That's why he was up there. As for this Moses, we don't know what has become of him. Now, watch this. Give me Matthew chapter 28, verse 6. Matthew 28 and verse 6. Watch this thing. Okay?
The book of Matthew, chapter 28, verse 6.
Read.
He is not here.
Meaning what? But remember, this after he resurrected now. He risen, he left the sepulchre. Read.
For he is risen, as he said.
He is risen as he said. Meaning what? Out of his mouth. He risen as he said, because they didn't believe what he said. Read.
Come. He says, see the place where the Lord lay.
You see that thing? He says, come, see the place where the Lord lay. Watch this. Give me 1 Corinthians 15, verse 3 now. I knew I was getting ahead of myself. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 3. Watch this. Remember, he says, Christ is the first begotten, he's the first fruit, he's the firstborn of the day, of them that slept. Okay? Now, he's saying he's going to resurrect the third day, as he said, out of his own mouth. Okay? 1 Corinthians 15 verse 3. Listen to the what the Apostle Paul is saying in the Spirit of Christ.
1 book of Corinthians chapter 15 verse 3. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. How that Christ died for our sins.
Christ died for our sins, read.
According to the scriptures.
According to as it is written, read.
And that he was buried.
That he was buried. That's the same thing we read in the book of Matthew 12, 39. Read.
And that he rose again the third day.
He did what?
He rose again the third day.
He rose again the third day. The third day. Read.
According to the scriptures.
According to the scriptures. So when he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, he was that first fruits. He was the first fruits. When did he rise? Read that again.
And he rose again the third day.
He rose again the third day. The third day. Watch this. Romans 6 verse 3. Romans chapter 6 verse 3. Come on. He rose again the third day. He rose the third day. Watch this.
The book of Romans chapter 6 verse 10.
No, verse 3. Come on.
Romans chapter 6 verse 3. Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death.
Is there so many of us were baptized into Jesus? Were baptized into his death? He's asking the question. Read.
Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death.
Where he says, therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into his death. Read.
That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father.
So Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father. Come on.
Even so, we also should walk in newness of life.
We should walk in newness of life. Watch what he says now. Come on.
For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death.
If we have been planted together in the likeness of his death. Planted together in the likeness of his death. Read.
We shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection.
Stop right there. Read that part again.
He says, we
shall also, as we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. When did Christ rise? The third day. The third day as the first fruits of the dead. Next verse. Next part of the verse. Come on.
Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him.
Our old man is crucified with him. Read.
That the body of sin might be destroyed.
So everything that Christ did was symbolic of what we must do in the spirit. Okay, come on.
That henceforth we should not serve sin.
Read.
For he that is dead is freed from sin.
Read on.
Now, if we be dead with Christ,
it's talking about what? The old man that must be crucified. How do you crucify the old man? You repent. Read.
We believe that we shall also live with him. That we shall also live with him.
If we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. So now, Christ rose the third day. You understand? He died and he rose the third day. Guess what? We also must do the same thing. His death symbolizes our spiritual death. That with the old man will be put to death the same way Christ died. And the third day Christ rose. We also must rise up. Just like he did. Spiritually though. That's why he was telling Nicodemus, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. What was he saying? Spiritually, Nicodemus was thinking he meant it what? Literally, that's what he thought. No. Watch this. Give me Romans 6. Go back to Romans 6, verse 4 and 5 again. Romans 6, verse 4 and 5.
Chapter 6, verse 4.
Read.
Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death. That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father.
Read.
Even so, we also should walk in newness of life.
Next verse.
For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death.
Read.
we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection.
We shall also in the likeness of his resurrection. Watch this. Give me the book of John 5:28. The same way Christ died and resurrected, we also must die and be resurrected. Because he was the first fruit of the dead that slept. The first fruit of the what? The firstborn of the because of what? The, no, no, I'm messing it up. I'm going to mess it up. I'm paraphrasing it. Go back to Revelation 1 and 5. I don't want to mess this up. Okay? Revelation 1 verse 5.
The book of Revelation, chapter 1 verse 5.
Read.
And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead.
The what?
The first begotten of the dead.
What's that word?
The first begotten of the dead.
The first begotten of the dead. Them that slept. That's us. Right? Okay. Matthew now. Chapter 5, 28. No, no. John. John 5, 28. Not Matthew. John 5, 28. Watch this.
The book of John. Chapter 5, verse 28.
Come on.
Marvel not at this.
He says, don't marvel. Marvel not at this. Don't marvel of what you are seeing right now going on. Don't marvel. Read.
For the hour is coming.
For the hour is coming.
In the which all that are in the grave.
All that are dead or are slept. Come on.
Shall hear his voice.
Shall hear his voice. That's what you are seeing right now. All that are dead, all that are in the graves, all that have slumbered and slept, shall what?
Shall hear his voice.
Shall hear his voice. Watch this. Give me the book of 2 Exodus 9:31. 2 Exodus. Chapter 9, verse 31.
Second book of Ezra, chapter 9, verse 31.
Come on.
For behold, I saw my law in you.
Stop right there. He says, I what?
I saw my law in you.
He says, behold, I saw, I'm going to plant my law in you. Okay, come on.
And it shall bring fruit in you.
And it, the laws of God will bring fruit in you. Read.
And ye shall be honored in it forever.
You shall be honored in the law that will bring fruit in you forever when you get the kingdom. Read that again.
2 Ezra chapter 9 verse 81.
Read.
For behold, I saw my law in you.
I saw my law in you. Read on.
And it shall bring fruit in you.
It shall bring fruit in you. Read.
And ye shall be honored in it forever.
Why will the Lord do this day? Why will he do it? Hosea 6 verse 1. Watch this. Watch how this comes together. He says, I will sow my law in you, and it shall bring forth fruit in you, and you shall be honored in it forever. When will the Lord do it? Hosea 6 and 1. Watch this.
The book of Hosea, 6 verse 1.
Come on.
Come, and let us return unto the Lord, for he has torn, and he will heal us.
The Lord torn us apart. You know, he destroyed us, he sent us into slavery, captivity, colonization. Read.
And he will heal us.
The Lord will heal us. This is the healing of the Lord right now. Read.
He has smitten.
He has smitten.
And he will bind us up.
That's when we were taken. You read Revelation chapter 1, chapter 11, verse 11 and 12. Read on.
After 2 days, will he revive us.
After 2 days, the Lord will revive us. Read again.
After 2 days, will he revive us.
After 2 days, will he revive us. Read on.
In the third day.
In the what day?
In the third day.
In the what day?
In the third day.
In the third day, what will the Lord do?
He will rise up.
He will what?
He will rise us up.
In the third day, he will rise us up. Go ahead.
And we shall live in his sight.
Now watch this. Hold this. We're coming back here. Give me the book of 2 Peter 3. That's some beautiful stuff right here. All praise to the Most High God. First Peter. Is this First Peter? 2 Peter chapter 3. Okay, 2 Peter chapter 3. Is it verse 8?
Yes, sir.
No. 2 Peter, right? Yeah. 2 Peter 3 verse 8. Whew. Come on, give me that thing.
3 verse 8.
Read.
But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing.
Don't be ignorant, brothers. Don't be ignorant of this one thing. Read.
That one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years.
Whoa. That what?
that one day is with the Lord as a thousand years.
That one day is with the Lord as a what?
As a thousand years.
As a thousand years. Go ahead.
And a thousand years as one day.
And a thousand years as one day. Is that it, Combat?
Yes, sir.
Read again, read again.
2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8.
Come on.
But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing.
Don't be ignorant of this one thing, brothers and sisters.
That one day is with the Lord as a thousand years.
One day with the Most High God is what is equal to 1,000 years. Read.
And a thousand years as one day.
A thousand years as one day. Watch this. Go back now to where we was at. Hosea 6, verse 2 again.
The book of Hosea, chapter 6, verse 2. After 2 days.
After what?
After 2 days.
After 2 days. That means what? One day is with the Lord as a what? As a thousand years. So after 2,000 years. That's some heavy stuff. Read that part again.
Hosea chapter 6, verse 2.
Read.
After 2 days will he revive us.
After 2 days will he revive us. Come on.
In the third day.
In the third day. We are in the third day right now.
He will rise us up.
He will what?
He will rise us up.
In the third day, he will rise us up. Read.
And we shall live in his sight.
Right now, we are in the third day, brothers and sisters. We are in the third day. Just like Christ resurrected from the dead on the third day, became the first fruits of what? The first begotten of the dead. Guess what? The Lord is rising up, is rising us up on the third day. We are in the third day right now. Watch this. James chapter 1, verse 18. James 1, verse 18. Watch this.
The book of James, chapter 1, verse 18.
Come on.
Of his own will beget he us of the word of truth.
Of his own will beget he. That's Christ, he beget us. With the word of truth, meaning the law. He sown his word in us. Remember that. Go back to St. Ezra's. Chapter 9, verse 31. Of his own will beget he us with the word of truth. How did he beget us? With the word of truth. How did that happen? This is how it happened. 2 Ezra 9:31.
2 book of Ezra, chapter 9, verse 81.
Come on.
For behold, I saw my law in you.
I saw my law in you.
And it shall bring fruit in you.
It shall bring fruit in you. That's what we just read now. It says what? It says, of his own will beget he us. With the word of truth. How did he do it? He sown his word in us. Read that again.
2 Ezra chapter 9, verse 81.
Read.
For behold, I saw my law in you, and it shall bring fruit in you, and he shall be honored in it forever.
Now go back to James chapter 1, verse 18 now.
The book of James chapter 1, verse 18.
Read.
Of his own will, beget he us of the word of truth.
Of his own will beget he us with the word of truth. How did he do it? He sown his word in us. And that word will do what? Will bring forth fruit in us. Read.
That we should be.
That we, that what?
That we.
That we, that we, that we, come on.
That we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures.
That's some heavy stuff right there. That's some heavy stuff right there. That we should become what?
That we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures.
That we should become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. That's beautiful right there. Now go back to 1 Corinthians 15 verse 20 now. Okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now we have a better understanding of why Christ died and resurrected, that we should also destroy the old man with his sinful deeds and we should walk in the newness of life. The third day, the same way he rose the third day, we must do it. And when he rose the third day, he became what? 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20.
Corinthians chapter 15, verse 20. But now is Christ risen from the dead.
He risen from the dead. When? 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 4.
1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 4.
Come on.
And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day.
He rose again the third day. Go ahead.
According to the scripture.
According to as it is written. Go back to verse 20 again.
Verse 20. But now is Christ risen from the dead.
Read.
And become the first fruits of them that slept.
You see that thing? Christ risen from the dead. When? The third day. According to 1 Corinthians 15 verse 4. And become the first fruits of them that slept. Who's the them that slept? It's us. And when will the Lord wake us up on the third day? We are in the third day right now. And as we're waking up the third day, we become what? Go back to where we said now, James 1:18. Again.
The book of James, chapter 1, verse 18.
Read.
Of his own will beget he us with the will of truth.
Read.
That we should be a kind of first fruits of his creature.
That we should become a kind of first fruits of his creature, meaning of his creation. We must be a first fruit of his creation. I need you men to pay attention. I need you brothers to stay focused. Because here's the thing. Don't get distracted by nothing. Watch this. Spirits are jumping on this thing. Give me that in 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel, okay? 1 Samuel. 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel chapter 5, I believe. 2 Samuel chapter 5. Let me see. Give me 1 second. Give me 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 1. Now, at this point, we had returned the Ark of the Covenant, right? Watch this.
2 book of Samuel, chapter 7, verse 1. And it came to pass, when the king sat in his house, and the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies.
So now David now has been given rest from all his enemies. Read. Jump down to verse 4.
Verse 4. And it came to pass that night, that the word of the Lord came unto Nathan, saying, go and tell my servant David, thou saith the Lord.
No. You know what? No. I'm getting ahead of myself. No. 1 Samuel 6 and 1. That's now after the ark has returned. At this point, we are moving the ark.
1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1. And the ark of the Lord was in the country.
2 Samuel 6, verse 1.
Second Samuel chapter 6, verse 1.
Read.
Again. David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000, and David arose and went with all the people.
So David went with all the people. He chose 30,000. He chose what? 30,000 men. He says chosen men of Israel, 30,000. That's very important. Chosen men. Not everybody can be on the front line, but everybody is important. Everyone is necessary. Everybody get that?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
And went with all the people that were with him from Baal of Judah to bring up from thence the ark of God.
The ark of God. So they are going to get the ark of God. Watch this.
Whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts that dwelleth between the cherubims.
Now watch this. Now we understand David went to retrieve the ark, right? Jump down to verse 12.
Verse 12.
Now David is excited. The ark is back. Okay, watch this.
And it was told King David, saying, the Lord bless the house of Obed-Edom.
Obed-Edom. No, it's not an Edomite. That's just his name. Read.
And all that pertaineth unto him because of the ark of God.
Because he had what? He had the ark of the covenant in his house. Read on. Retrieved from the Philistines. Read.
So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness.
With what?
With gladness.
With gladness. Now they went to the Obed-Edom's house to retrieve the ark. The ark is not back yet, but they are now retrieving it from that man's house. He was an Israelite. Read.
And it was so. And when they that bare the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed oxen and fatness.
Read.
And David danced.
Stop right there. Wait. Verse 14 again.
And David danced before the Lord.
So now, hold on. Yes, the ark now has been returned. Now David is saying, listen, we need to offer sacrifices now. Everybody's happy. Because remember, when the ark was not with us, listen, we were catching hell. Right now, are we not in captivity? Do we have the ark?
Yes,
no. Are we not catching hell? Yes, we are catching hell. Now, keep reading. Read verse 14 again.
2 Samuel chapter 6 verse 14.
Read.
And David danced before the Lord.
David danced before the Lord, come on.
With all his might.
With what?
With all his might.
With all his might. He was excited, he was dancing. Next verse, go ahead.
And David was girded with a linen ephod.
He was girded with a linen ephod. Okay, meaning around his waist. Read.
So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord
with what? Shouting. With shouting. Oh yes, I'm sorry. They are bringing the ark. Okay, go ahead.
With shouting and with the sound of the trumpet.
With the sound of the trumpet, read.
And as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David.
Now the ark of the Lord is coming into the city of David. Everyone is excited. So at the house of Abel-Edom, they sacrificed. Because all praise to the Most High, we got the ark. Now let's take it to the city of David. Because before that, the chapter before it, David was made king. He's the king now. Okay? Read.
Michal,
this is Saul's daughter now.
What Saul's is? Daughter looked through a window.
Remember, David was dancing. Mighty heart too. Okay? It says, and Michal, Saul's daughter, looked through a window. Read.
And saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord.
He saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord. He was rejoicing. Okay? He was in the spirit of joy and gladness. Watch this.
And she despised him. In your heart.
Stop right there. Read the part again. She did what?
And she despised him in her heart.
Hold on a second. You sisters, do not be stressing the black man on this day. You black men, don't get distracted by a sister that is not moving in the right spirit. If I see you, I will check you. Look at what King David was doing. We just returned the ark. Everybody's excited because the Lord will be with us. Today, the Lord has just resurrected us from the dead. We are the first, we are a kind of first fruits. We are observing the feast of Pentecost in the spirit of joy and gladness. And guess what? I don't want to see any brother be distracted by a sister because what? The sister is mad about something. Next verse.
And they brought in the ark of the Lord and set it in his place.
They brought in the ark of the Lord and set it in his place. Watch this.
In the midst of the tabernacle that David had pitched for it.
Read.
And David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord.
Now jump down to verse 20 now. Watch this.
Verse 20. Then David returned to bless his household.
Remember, don't forget what Michal, Saul's daughter, did now. She was despised in her heart because of what David was doing. Verse 20 again.
2 Samuel chapter 6 verse 20. Then David returned to bless his household. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David.
Now she's coming to meet David now. Watch this. Remember, she was watching him, right? Go ahead.
And said, how glorious was the king of Israel today.
How glorious was the king of Israel today. She wasn't meaning it. She was being sarcastic. You know, she was being facetious. Is that the word?
Yes.
Prince?
Who uncovered himself today?
Who did what?
Who uncovered himself.
Come on.
Today in the eyes of the handmaids of his servants.
He says, who uncovered himself beside what? He says, he uncovered himself today in the eyes of the handmaids of his servants. So there were the sisters that was excited that King David returned the ark. Here's this black ashy demon want to get King David out of the spirit. You see that thing? So now, read on.
As one of
it's like days. You see, it's like right now. Now we start to have, we start to eat. Everybody's happy. I remove my girdle. You see my linen girdle? Now my garment is just moving. I'm excited. There's a black ishi demon sitting right there. So that nigga right there. Okay, read on again.
2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 20.
Read.
Then David returned to bless his household. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, how glorious was the king of Israel today,
read.
Who uncovered himself today in the eyes of the handmaids of his servants, as one of the vain fellows shamelessly uncovered himself.
You see what she's speaking disrespectfully. She's supposed to be happy that the ark is back. Her concern was King David was dancing before the Lord. It's even written, before the Lord he was dancing. She was mad as hell. Okay? She was mad. She was up the spirit. Now read the next verse.
And David said unto Michal.
Now listen what David says now.
It was before the Lord.
It was before the Lord. Come on.
Which chose me before thy father.
It was before the Lord which chose me before thy father. The Most High God chose me before your father. Read.
and before all his house,
and before all his house,
to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord,
and
over Israel.
Over Israel. And guess what? That scripture talks to you, brothers, today, you men. The Lord has chosen you to go out there and fight the battle of Israel. That's a glorious thing right there. You are enrolled into God's army. You have been recruited into God's army. This is not the Christian church. Really?
Therefore, will I play before the Lord.
You see what David is saying? He said, listen, to hell with that. I want to play before the Lord. I want to dance in mighty heart too. Okay, go ahead.
And I will yet be more vile than thus.
You see what he's saying? I'm going to do even more. Yeah. I'm going to add more dances to this. Now that you are saying this. Oh, you mad? You're not going to see nothing. You haven't seen nothing yet. You mad? Mm-mm. He said, listen, if we're going to leave now, we're going to leave in the next 2 hours now. If you thought we're leaving now, the next 2 hours we're leaving. That's what David is saying right here. Go ahead.
And will be based in my own sight.
I will be based in my own sight. I'm going to dance. Are you saying I'm dancing shamelessly? I'm going to dance even harder now. Read.
And of the maidservants.
And of the maidservants that she was complaining about.
Which thou hast spoken of.
That you are speaking evil of.
Of them shall I be had in honor.
Of them shall I be had in honor. He says they will honor me then. That's some heavy stuff right there. So now, with that, we say shalom.
Oh, praise
God. Oh, praise the Most High. Oh, praise the Most High. Oh, praise. Oh, praise. Oh, praise to the Most High. I'm going to end the class right here. Let's break bread. Okay, everybody get bread and wine. Okay, sisters, administer the wine and all that. Okay, and the bread. Okay.